Are your judgments true? By the way, I have noticed that Jesus did save a very stern rebuke for people who were judgmental. And who were the judgmental ones in his day? The Pharisees. Who were the Pharisees? What was their job? This is the interactive portion of the program. They were the religious and political leaders of Israel. They ran Israel, along with the Sadducees, who didn't believe in the resurrection. That's why they were Sadducee. This is sophisticated theology here, ladies and gentlemen. Anyway, they ran Israel, and Jesus went after them. Are you telling me Jesus got involved in politics? Yes, and he wasn't so nice doing it. In fact, if you think Jesus was a nice guy who never said a bad word about anyone, you have not read John chapter 8 or Matthew chapter 23. What does Jesus say in John chapter 8? He's talking to these Pharisees. He says this to them. Your father is the devil. Jesus, that's not very Christ-like of you. What is wrong with you? That's offensive. Can you imagine saying that to somebody? Your father is the devil. And then in Matthew 23, he says, woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, you brood of vipers, you hypocrites. You strain out a gnat and swallow a camel. Oh, you look great on the outside. You're whitewashed tombs, but on the inside, you're full of dead men's bones. You go a mile to make a convert, and then once you make them a convert, you make them twice as much a son of hell as you are. How will you avoid being condemned to hell? What? Sweet and gentle Jesus said this? Yes, Jesus was not Barney. Can't we all just get along, boys and girls? No, I came to bring a sword. It's going to divide father and son, mother and daughter. He was not Mr. Rogers. You guys know who Mr. Rogers was? Can you say kindness, boys and girls? I mean, he was kind most of the time, but he certainly didn't go around saying, this sermon brought to you by the letter Q. No, Jesus was tough. And by the way, sometimes you got to tell people directly that they're wrong. If you don't, you're enabling them. By the way, Jesus said this in John 7:24. He said, stop judging by mere appearances and make a right judgment. Everybody's got to make judgments. Now, for Christians in here, we've got to make judgments just like everybody else without being judgmental. Somebody put it this way, evangelism is just one beggar showing another beggar where the food is. We're no better than anybody else. By the way, I've noticed one thing about judging. You ever notice that when you compliment somebody, which is a judgment, nobody gets upset? You know, you say to your best friend, you know, I really love you. You're such a wonderful person. I wish I could be like you. Do you think your friend's going to go, who do you think you are? Are you judging me? You think you're worse than me? No, your friend's never going to say that. Why? I've noticed that people don't really have a problem with judging. They just have a problem with judgments they don't like. And if you tell somebody something that's true and they get upset, you just help convict them. As Augustine said, we love the truth when it enlightens us. We hate the truth when it convicts us. Jesus put it this way. Men love darkness rather than light. For you military guys in here, you always get more flack when you're over the target. If you tell somebody something that's true and they're upset, you're over the target. They don't want you to talk about this. So they'll emote back to you. Now, those are just some of the claims that are self-defeating. There are many others. The main point here is to turn the claim on itself. Now, can you see that this claim and the others we just went through, can you see that this claim shoots itself? Can everyone see that? Right? This is self-defeating. It can't be true. All right? Now, if our reasoning is good in point one here, relativism and or postmodernism can't be true because they're claiming it's true. There's no truth. It's like saying I can't speak a word in English. Now, you can't get away from truth. Actually, you can temporarily. How do you get away from it temporarily? You suppress it because you don't want it to be true, so you look the other way. And everybody does this, Christian, non-Christian. We all do this sometimes. We know the right thing to do, and we don't do it. We suppress it. We tell ourselves, no, I don't want to do that. By the way, I do this at a lot of college campuses, and we set up the microphone for Q&A, and we'll have some Q&A later. And if you're an atheist or a non-Christian here. Thank you for coming. We'll have some dialogue later. It'll be fun. But I want to give you a heads up. During the Q&A, I may ask you a question. Here's the question, so you can think about it. So I don't want to catch you on the spot. Here's the question. If Christianity were true, would you become a Christian? I've had atheists stand at the microphone in front of hundreds of people. I ask that question. They say, no! No? How's that reasonable? How's that rational? It's not. The problem isn't here in that case. The problem's here. And I'm not saying this is true of everyone. Don't get me wrong. But the people that have said no, the problem isn't here. It's here. They don't want it to be true. They've admitted to me privately, I don't want there to be a God. I don't want there to be a moral standard outside of my own desires. In fact, Christopher Hitchens, in fact, admitted that. I had the opportunity to debate him a couple of times. You guys know who Christopher Hitchens was? A brilliant British atheist who sounded more brilliant than he was because he had a British accent. In one of our debates, he called God a cosmic North Korean dictator peering in on our sex lives. Now, that's great imagery, actually. Hitchens was great, right? A cosmic North Korean dictator peering in on our sex lives. He didn't want there to be a God because he didn't want to have a standard beyond him. In fact, he didn't call himself an atheist. He called himself an anti-theist. It's not just that I don't believe in God. I don't want there to be a God. Now, by the way, Christians, this applies to you too. If an atheist say, well, if atheism were true, you become an atheist. My answer is yes, but there's no way of showing it's true. Because if atheism is true, the materialistic kind of atheist that most atheists believe today, if we're just molecules in motion, if we're just moist robots, we don't have any warrant to believe anything we think is true. Because we're not reasoning to a conclusion. Every thought we have is the result of the laws of physics over which we have no control. So why should I believe atheism's true, Christianity's true, or anything's true? I'm just a moist robot if atheism's true. So anyway, during the Q&A, we may do some of that, all right? So get ready for that. Let's go on now to the next question. Does God exist? We know that truth exists, which means Christianity could be true, atheism could be true, some other worldview could be true. But is it true that God exists? And I mentioned there are three arguments we're going to briefly look at for the existence of a theistic God. The first argument is the argument from the beginning of the universe, known as the cosmological argument. Cosmological comes from the Greek word cosmos, which means world or universe, and it says that the universe had a beginning, it must have had a beginner. The second argument is the argument from design, known as the teleological argument. Telos is a Greek word meaning design or purpose, and it says if there's design in the universe and design in you, in life, then there must be a designer. Now, these two arguments have scientific evidence behind them. The third argument doesn't have any science behind it. It's more philosophical in nature, yet it's the argument we've all known since we were very small children, and it's the argument from morality known as the moral argument. And it says if there's one thing morally wrong out there, just one, like it's wrong to torture babies for fun, or it's wrong to murder 6 million people in a Holocaust, or it's wrong to walk into a school, a middle school, and shoot students, then there has to be a God. Why? Because if there is no standard beyond humanity, then everything's just a matter of opinion. That's just your opinion against a baby torturer's opinion, your opinion against Hitler's opinion, your opinion against a school shooter's opinion. We all know that certain things are right and other things are wrong, so there must be a standard beyond us whose essence is goodness, justice, righteousness. We'll get to that later. Let's start here at the beginning argument, the cosmological argument, and this is the argument that many say points back to the big... Now, some of you Christians in here are going, Frank, you know, we're Christians in here. We don't believe in the Big Bang. You guys don't believe in the Big Bang? I believe in the Big Bang. I just know who banged it. In fact, you even have atheistic scientists admitting this. Stephen Hawking, who, as you know, just passed away last week. By the way, Hawking, a medical miracle. Do you know he has had ALS for like 50 years? They gave him 2 years to live. He said, oh, yeah, how about I go another 50? Amazing. Anyway, here's what Hawking said. He said, almost everyone now believes that the universe and time itself had a beginning at the Big Bang. Now, Hawking tries to come up with another explanation other than God. I think he fails at that. In fact, just last week or the week before, he was talking about imaginary time. Well, that was a theory he had 40 years ago, which even he admitted didn't work. He's trying to bring it back, it seems, to avoid God. He's admitting that space, matter, and time had a beginning out of nothing. A colleague of his by the name of Alexander Vilenkin, a Russian cosmologist who teaches at Tufts University put it this way. He said, with the proof now in place, cosmologists, by the way, a cosmologist is not somebody that puts on your makeup, all right? That's somebody who studies the origin of the universe. Cosmologists can no longer hide behind the possibility of a past eternal universe. There is now no escape. They have to face the problem of a cosmic beginning. Now, this guy, Vilenkin, 6 years ago went to Hawking's 70th birthday party, and he gave a paper. I guess scientists give papers at birthday parties, all right? And what he did in this paper was he said, all the evidence we have from every discipline I know about points to the fact that the universe had a beginning. That's why he says, with the proof now in place. Now, Vilenkin is actually a believer in the multiverse. You guys know what the multiverse is? There are maybe other universes out there, and ours just happens to look designed, even though it isn't designed. It was just kind of the luck of the draw. But even Vilenkin admits that even if there are other universes out there, which you can't detect because they're beyond our universe, even if there are other universes out there, he says the whole show, all the universes together need an absolute beginning. Now, why is Vilenkin and Hawking and others coming to the conclusion that space, matter, and time had a beginning? We're not even going to go through the evidence tonight. A, we don't have time. B, it's all in the book. And C, it's not controversial. Everyone is admitting that the universe had a beginning. The question is, what began it? Well, it seems to me that if space, matter, and time had a beginning, then whatever created space, matter, and time can't be made of space, matter, and time. In other words, the cause must transcend space, matter, and time. In other words, the cause must be spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful to create the universe out of nothing, personal in order to choose to create, because in order to create, you got to make a choice, and only persons can make choices. Also intelligent, because you got to be intelligent to make a choice. Now again, when you think about a spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful, personal, intelligent cause, who do you think of? That's what we mean by God. Well, how do you know it's the Christian God? We don't. We don't know if this is the Christian God yet. We just know it could be the Christian God. Maybe this is another God. Maybe this is Allah, or maybe this is some other theistic God. We don't know yet. No argument gets you all the way there. It just seems like there's a being that suspiciously looks like the God of the Bible. Now, as I say, there's a lot more to talk about with this argument, but we'll save it for the Q&A. We've got to go to the design argument, the teleological argument. And there are two aspects to the design argument. The fact that the universe appears designed, and so does life. Let's talk about the universe first. There's something scientists have discovered recently called the fine-tuning of the universe. When I say recently, the past half century. They've discovered that there are aspects about our universe that are so precisely tweaked that if you were to change any one of a number of factors about our universe, whether they're the laws of nature, the constants in the laws of nature, certain ratios of particles, elementary particles, if you were to change any of those slightly, there would be no universe and certainly no life. Let me just give you a couple of these. We'll start again with Stephen Hawking, who said this: if the expansion rate of the universe was different by one part in 1,000,000,000,000 a second after the Big Bang, the universe would have collapsed back on itself or never developed galaxies. If you were to change the expansion rate that infinitesimal amount from the very beginning, there would be no universe. We wouldn't be here. Now, you can't make any evolutionary argument for this. Why? Because the expansion rate did not evolve to this point. The expansion rate started this way. In other words, it's part of the initial conditions of the universe. And quite frequently, some people will say, well, if macroevolution is true, there's no need for God. Well, that's silly, because before you ever get to biology, you need a universe. And the universe, long before there was any life on it, had to be created and designed. So whether or not macroevolution is true is irrelevant to this question. You need a creator and a designer from the very beginning. The same thing is true, by the way, with the gravitational force. If it were altered by more than one part in 10 to the 40th power, we wouldn't be here. You go, what's one part in 10 to the 40th power? That's one in one with 40 zeros following it. You say, Frank, I can't get my head around that number. Neither can I. Let me give you an illustration. Take a tape measure and stretch it across the entire known universe. That's a long way, by the way. Set the gravitational force at a particular inch mark on that tape measure. I realize gravity is not measured in inches, but this is just to give you a scale idea in your mind. If the strength of gravity was different by 1 inch in either direction, across the scale as wide as the entire known universe, we wouldn't be here. I don't have enough faith to believe that that happened by chance. In fact, when scientists use the word chance, what do they mean? Is chance a cause? Does chance cause things? Who caused this? Chance, he was just here. No. Chance is not a cause. Chance is a word we use to describe mathematical possibilities. When scientists are using the word chance, normally what they mean is some unknown combination of forces we have no idea what they are. Basically, chance means we don't know. It seems to me the best explanation is the same being that created the universe and fine-tuned the expansion rate is the same being that put the gravitational force and about 20 other constants like this right where it is. In fact, Hitchens, to his credit, admitted this was the hardest argument to answer from an atheistic perspective. Also, you could make an argument our solar system is designed. Where are we in the solar system? Right here. If you're older people, third rock from the sun, right? Who said you don't learn from sitcoms? Right there. If we were just a little bit closer to or a little bit further away from the sun, we couldn't survive. A little bit closer to, we'd burn up. A little bit further away, we'd freeze. We are what scientists call the Goldilocks zone. It's not too hot. It's not too cold. It is? That's a lie. It's too hot here in the summer. The axial tilt, 23.5 degrees. Change that slightly, we don't exist. Earth rotation, 24 hours. Change that slightly, we don't exist. The size and distance of the moon from us. Change that slightly, we don't exist. Oxygen in this room right now is 21%. If it were 15%, we'd all suffocate. If it were 25%, spontaneous fires would break out. If Jupiter right here was not in its current orbit, we couldn't exist. What does Jupiter do for us? Anyone know? Yeah, it's an asteroid magnet. Jupiter's gravitational force is so strong that it attracts most of the meteors and space junk to it rather than us. Saturn does the same thing, by the way. In fact, you want to see a close-up look of Jupiter? You know what these purple marks are right here? Those purple marks are comet fragment strikes that are bigger than the Earth. Thank God for Jupiter. Because if Jupiter wasn't there, we wouldn't be here. In fact, you want to see the size of Jupiter? Check this out. Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, Earth. Look at poor Pluto down here. You know, Pluto recently has been demoted as a planet. I don't know about you, but I think it's size discrimination. Take a look at this. You can hardly see Pluto. Take a look at this. That's Arcturus. That's another star in our galaxy. Here's the sun over here. Jupiter is one pixel in size on this scale. Earth is invisible. Pluto? Forget about it. All right, you got Arcturus now? Keep an eye on Arcturus. Where's Arcturus now? Left of the white star Regal. That's Antares. That's another star in our galaxy. The sun is one pixel in size on this scale. Jupiter is invisible. Earth, Pluto, forget about it. In fact, if the Earth was the size of a golf ball, Betelgeuse here would be 5 or 6 Empire State Buildings high. The heavens are awesome. This is just in our galaxy. This is not outside our galaxy. This is in our galaxy. In fact, the average distance between stars in our galaxy is 30 trillion miles. And all that distance is necessary for us to exist here on Earth based on the current laws of physics. Now, 30 trillion miles, how far is that? Far. Take you at least 2 tanks of gas and a Toyota Prius to go 30 trillion miles. A number of years ago, I was at the Desert Museum in Tucson, Arizona. If you ever get to go to Tucson, outside the city a little ways, they have this museum. And it's right out in the middle of the desert, far from the city lights. And if you go there at night, on a clear night, they'll take you outside because you can see thousands of stars in the sky. So we're out there one night, and the guide goes, wow, it's so clear tonight that if we look up at 9:03, we're going to see the space shuttle in orbit. I said, oh, come on. We're not going to see the space shuttle. I mean, it's only 120 feet long. It's 350 miles up. We're not going to see it. Oh, me of little faith. At 9:03, the guide goes, look! And we look up in the sky about 70 degrees above the horizon. There's an object streaking across the sky relative to us about like this. When it got right about here, it disappeared. I don't know whether Scotty beamed it up or what. Actually, what happened was, despite the fact that we were in total darkness, the space shuttle was so high up, the sun was still reflecting off of it, and when it got out of the range of the sun, we couldn't see it anymore. Now, when the space shuttle was in orbit, the space shuttle was traveling at about 18,000 miles an hour. That's 5 miles per second. You got trouble getting to school in the morning? Take the space shuttle. You'll be 5 miles a second. Think about how fast that is. Well, I did a little calculation to try and figure out how long would it take us if we could get in the space shuttle and go from our star, the sun, to another star in our galaxy an average distance away 30 trillion miles. In other words, how long would it take us to go 30 trillion miles if we could go 5 miles per second? How long do you think it would take us? Years? It would take us 201,450 years. That means if you got in the space shuttle at the time of Christ and started traveling from our star, the sun, to another star in our galaxy an average distance away, you've been going 5 miles a second for 2,000 years, you'd be less than 1/100th of the way there right now. And we're going to explore space. No, we're not. We're not going anywhere in space. We can hardly get out of our solar system. It took us 9 years to get to Pluto. We can't get to another planet. In fact, how many stars are out there? Another planet outside of our solar system. How many stars are out there? You know how many stars are out there? The number of stars that are out there are about equivalent to the number of grains of sand on all the beaches on all the Earth. See this picture right here? This is from the ground. That square right there, that's from the Hubble Space Telescope. The heavens are awesome. February 1st, 2003, just over 15 years ago, President George W. Bush went into the East Room of the White House. They turned the TV camera on. It's Saturday afternoon. Every major network, even international networks, carried his address. Saturday afternoon, why? The president looked in the camera and said, my fellow Americans, this morning our country experienced a great tragedy. Upon re-entry into the atmosphere, the space shuttle Columbia burned up in the skies over Texas. There are no survivors. The Columbia is lost. The president then read from Isaiah chapter 40. Why Isaiah chapter 40? Because in Isaiah chapter 40, God is speaking. And what does God say? To whom will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One. In other words, you want a comparison? You want to know what God is like? Here it is. Lift your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these stars and named them one by one? Because of his great power and mighty strength. Not one of them is missing. The president then looked back in the camera and said, the same God that created and named all those stars is the same God that created and knows the names of the 7 astronauts who perished today. While they did not return safely home to us, we can all now pray they've all returned safely home. You want to know who God is like? Most of us have the wrong idea of who God is like. We think God is like a big angel. No, you want to know what God is like? Both the Old and the New Testament says, look to the heavens. What do you see when you look to the heavens? You see stars equivalent to grains of sand on all the beaches on all the earth. 200,000 years at 5 miles a second between those stars. That gives you a sense of infinity. That's the point. In fact, you want to know what God is like? Meditate on the attributes of God. He's spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful, moral, personal, intelligent, all-knowing, all just, all love. Meditate on those attributes, then remove all limits from your mind. That's God. In fact, take the word God out of your vocabulary for a minute. Here's my question. Who is the source and sustainer of all things? Who is the source and sustainer of all things? Why is there a second commandment, thou shalt make no graven image? Because any image you make of an infinite being necessarily limits his majesty. You can't draw a picture of an infinite being. Oh, you can draw a picture of Jesus. Why? Because Jesus had two natures. He had a divine nature, which you can't draw. It's infinite. And he had a human nature, which you can draw. It's finite. Now, as amazing as the heavens are, you are actually more amazing. As amazing as the heavens are, they're not made in the image of God, but you are made in the image of God. What does that mean, to be made in the image of God? It doesn't mean you look like God, because he's an immaterial being. It means you're a person like God. You have mind, emotion, and will, that you can make choices, that you can create. You're a being, a free agent. In fact, let's go back to you in the womb at 11 weeks. Question, is this animal, mineral, vegetable, or human?
Human.
Human. In fact, let's go back even further. Let's go back even further than 11 weeks. Let's go back to when your mother and your father got together to conceive you. Have you guys had this talk before? I see some young people in here, so I'll try and be discreet. I also see some older people in here, so I'll try and be discreet as well, just in case you've forgotten how this works. When your mother and your father got together to conceive you, your mother unconsciously perfumed her egg to attract your father, and then your father sent the entire population of the United States, 300 million soldiers, toward your mother's egg, and then there was a race, and you won! Don't let anyone ever tell you you're not special. You beat out 300 million others. You have blown away anything Michael Phelps has done. Now, seeing some of you hobbling here earlier makes it hard for me to believe you were the fastest soldier in the gene pool. But you were. Now, your soldier was 20 to 30 times smaller than a grain of salt, yet it contained half of the 3.5 billion letter genome, your software program that makes you you, all the letters in the right order. And your mother's egg was about the size of a period at the end of a sentence in an average book. And it contained the other half of the 3.5 billion letter genome that makes you you, all the letters in the right order. And when your soldier and your egg came together, a new 100% genetic human being was created. You know, you have not received any more genetic information from this point till right now. In fact, there were only four things separating you from adulthood: time, air, water, and food. Those are the same four things that separated a two-year-old from adulthood. Does this have implications on the abortion issue? Yeah, I think it does. We don't kill the two-year-old. Why do we kill the unborn child in the womb? Genetically, it's the same. You say, wait a minute, Frank, time out. You can't legislate morality. All right, no extra charge for this, folks. This was the subject of our first book titled Legislating Morality. All laws legislate morality. Every law declares one behavior right and the opposite behavior wrong. The question isn't whether or not you can legislate morality. The question is, whose morality will we legislate? And when people say, don't impose your morality on me, I go, why not? Would that be immoral? Because you're imposing your morality on me right now. Actually, the better answer is this. This isn't my morality. I didn't make this stuff up. I didn't make up the fact that murder's wrong, that theft is wrong, that rape is wrong, that abortion's wrong, that men were made for women and women were made for men, and the best way to perpetuate and stabilize society is to legally recognize that relationship over every other relationship. I didn't make this stuff up. This isn't my morality. This is the morality. This is the one Thomas Jefferson said was self-evident. The one the Apostle Paul said, the Gentiles do not have the law of the law written on their hearts. You don't need the Bible to know right and wrong. You have the moral law written on your heart. The same God that inspired the Bible is the same God whose nature is what we call goodness or justice, and who gave us the moral law written on our hearts. If that law doesn't exist, then as Dostoevsky said, if there is no God, everything is permissible. So it isn't my morality. It's not your morality. It's the morality. All right, no extra charge for that. Let's go back to this. From this point till right now, a construction project of astonishing complexity began taking place. Cells began multiplying at a rate of 4,000 cells per second. Brain cells began multiplying at a rate of 100,000 cells per second. For most of you, anyway. Some cells became brain cells, other cells lung cells, others heart cells. How did they know how to do this? Nobody knows. Some cells went so far across you to become what they needed to become that it would be equivalent to you today walking across the United States alone. And that construction project continues to this day. You just made 4 million new red blood cells. You just made another 4 million new red blood cells. You just made another 4 million new red blood cells. Knock it off. How do you know how to do that? Are you even thinking about this? Are you going, hold on, Frank, time out. I got to make new red blood cells. No. You're not even thinking about this, yet it's happening. How is all this happening? In fact, Aristotle noticed 2,400 years ago that all of nature is going in a direction. If it's going in a direction, somebody must be directing it. In fact, take something that's not even conscious, like an acorn. Why does an acorn, if properly nourished, always become an oak tree? Why doesn't it become an elm tree or a birch tree or a seahorse? You say, well, Frank, it's programmed to become an oak tree. Yeah, well, who programmed it? And by the way, is an acorn conscious? Is an acorn sitting in the ground going, all right, what do I have to do to become an oak tree? No. Yet it reliably becomes an oak tree if it's properly nourished. Well, if it doesn't have a mind of its own, yet it's going in a direction, there must be an external mind directing it toward that end. That is what Aristotle called the unmoved mover. That is what Thomas Aquinas called in the 1200s AD, my fifth way to argue for God. All of nature's going in a direction. If it's going in a direction, there must be somebody directing it. In fact, you couldn't do science unless the world was orderly and everything was going in a direction. Well, why is it orderly? Why is it going in a direction? Because the world runs according to a mind. There's a mind that keeps everything going. Now, this argument that Aristotle developed 2,400 years ago and Thomas Aquinas perfected in the 1200s is true regardless of whether or not the universe had a beginning. The universe could be eternal, as Aristotle mistakenly thought. But you still need a cause here and now to keep everything going in the direction it's going. So this is not a cause back here. It's a cause right now as every moment passes. Now, there's a lot more in the Stealing from God book. If you want to go further than that, you can. But we've got to move on because we've got more to cover. Let's now talk about the moral argument. Let's say that we go out on a hike somewhere and we get lost. We're totally lost. We get turned around. We're out there for a few hours. Our cell phone dies. We don't know how to get back. We know the direction from which we came, but we can't figure out that direction. All we have to get us home is a magnetic compass. So you take out your magnetic compass, and you know a magnetic compass is supposed to point to magnetic north, but when you take out your compass, instead of pointing to magnetic north, your compass, no matter which way you turn, always points to you. How helpful would that compass be? Not going to be helpful at all. Well, question, why do we, whether we're Christians or not, think that the compass of life must always point to us? Why do we think that if things aren't going just the way we want, either God doesn't exist, he's evil, or he's forgotten about us? Do you realize that whether or not God exists, you are not the center of the universe? And neither am I. But why do we think that? And by the way, when it comes to right and wrong, is there a right way to live life? Do we determine right and wrong, or do we discover right and wrong? What is the truth? Where does the moral compass point? You know, you can't come up with a right way to live life unless there's a purpose to life. If there's no purpose to life, there's no right way to live it. Just like if there were no purpose to a football game, there'd be no way to discern whether your quarterback throwing a touchdown or your quarterback throwing an interception was better for you. If there's no purpose to the game, how could you tell? You couldn't. There's got to be a purpose to life in order for you to know the right way to live it. So the question is, do we determine right and wrong, or do we discover right and wrong? A little over 2 years ago, I was at a church in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. And I was speaking there over several nights, and we covered this material in a lot more detail than what we can do here right now. And the second night I was there, we had a microphone set up, and during the Q&A, a couple of young men in their 30s got up to, or actually in their 20s, got up to the microphone, and they began to express a lot of doubts about God. They were atheists, and I didn't think anything of it. If you call something, I don't have enough faith to be an atheist, atheists are going to show up. We had a nice dialogue. Again, I didn't think anything of it. The next night I was there, about a 50-year-old man got up to the microphone, and he had a question written on two sheets of paper, and he began to read the question. 10 seconds into the question, he broke down crying. He couldn't go any further. So I came off the platform, I went down to him, and he handed me the two sheets of paper, and he just said, "Read it, read it." So I'm reading this question to myself as I'm coming back up to the platform. I'm trying to digest the question. By the time I got back up to the platform, I realized that that man was upset for two reasons. By the way, his name happened to be Steve. Steve was upset because he had recently discovered that a supposed friend of his, a friend of the family by the name of Tom, who was also about 50 years old, had been sexually abusing Steve's daughter from the time she was age 4 to the time she was age 14. In his own home, under his nose, he never saw it. The second reason Steve was upset was because the two young men who were at the microphone the night before were his sons, who used to be Christians and are now atheists. After they discovered what had happened to their sister, they said, "There can't be a good God. He wouldn't have allowed this evil thing to happen if there was a good God. There is no God." In fact, one of the kids was going to a Roman Catholic seminary to become a priest, and after he heard the news, he said, "That's it, I'm done with God. There is no God." So I said, "Steve, it's okay to be mad at God. In fact, some of the Bible writers are mad at God. Read some of the Psalms, read Habakkuk, read Lamentations. God, where are you? Why is this happening? He's an infinite being. He can take it. It's okay to be mad at God. But I hope your sons are going to realize this is not a good argument against God. In fact, it's actually an argument for God." In fact, I said to Steve, I said, "I don't know when the right time is, Steve, but when the right time comes, I want you to say this to your sons. If there is no God, what that 50-year-old man did to your sister isn't really wrong. It's just your opinion. Because if there is no standard beyond humanity, no true compass beyond humanity, everything's a matter of opinion. I mean, where did Tom's compass point? It pointed to himself. If there is no compass outside of him, how can you say he's wrong? You can't." You say, "Well, how does this show God exists?" Because this wouldn't be evil unless there was a standard of good, and good wouldn't exist unless God existed, because what we mean by good is an objective standard of good outside of humanity. That's what we mean by God's nature. In fact, C.S. Lewis put it quite well. He said this: "The shadows prove the sunshine. In order to have shadows, you have to have sunshine. In other words, in order to have evil, you have to have good. Oh, you can have sunshine without shadows. You can have sunshine without shadows, but you can't have shadows without sunshine. You can't have evil without good." You say, "Why is that?" Because evil doesn't exist on its own. It exists as a lack or a privation in a good thing. Evil is like rust in a car. If you take all the rust out of the car, you got a better car. If you take all the car out of the rust, you got nothing. Evil is like cancer. If you take all the cancer out of a body, you got a better body. If you take all the body out of the cancer, you got nothing. Cancer doesn't exist unless there's a body to exist in. So if evil exists, then good exists. But if good exists, then God exists. Now, by the way, the guy who did this, everyone in the small town outside of Sioux Falls knows he's guilty. But he's not in jail. Why? Because every time the trial comes up, Jessica, the girl who was abused, psychologically checks out. She can't testify against him. If she doesn't testify, he doesn't go to jail. So I said, Steve, when the right time comes, I want you to say this to your sons. If there is no God, then the man who did this to your sister will never get justice. Well, he's not going to get justice here on earth if she doesn't testify, and he's not going to get justice in an afterlife because according to atheism, there is no afterlife. Do you really think that's the way the universe is? Do you really think there's no such thing as justice? The very reason you're upset, rightfully so, is because you know a great injustice has been done. But there can't be injustice unless there's justice. Something can't be not right unless something is right. Something can't be immoral unless something is moral. If there is no standard beyond us, everything's a matter of opinion. Now, by the way, I'm not saying atheists can't be moral. I'm not saying atheists can't know morality. I'm saying atheists can't justify morality. Because if we're just molecular machines, then nothing is ultimately right or wrong. There is no such thing as goodness, rightness, or justice. Because if we're just moist robots, if all that exists are materials, what is justice? How much carbon is in the justice molecule? You say, Frank, that's a stupid question. Yeah, it is a stupid question because justice is immaterial. It's not made of molecules. And everyone in here knows justice exists, which means that should tell you that materialism is false. Now, Jessica, the young girl who went through this, has since turned 18. She's actually 19 now. And she actually decided to have something good come out of this. She actually wrote a book. Here it is. Not Your Princess by Jessica Mitzel. And why am I telling you this? Because her father wants as many people to know that this happens far too often in American households. Adults, if a young person ever comes to you and says, Uncle Joe did this to me, do not dismiss it. What do you think, the kid's making it up? Oh, Uncle Joe would never do that. No, maybe Uncle Joe would. Jessica and other people like her have nowhere to turn. By the way, about 3 weeks ago, we're at the University of Indiana. Clint, my colleague, was on the, he's back there right now. There's Clint back there on the Facebook. We're streaming this live over Facebook. And he said, Steve Mitzel's on right now, watching this. I said, what's going on with Jessica? Jessica just started going back to church. She felt the Holy Spirit calling her. However, she's still in treatment. She's in treatment. $15,000 a month. Now, our culture wants to tell you that sex is just physical. Nonsense. If sex is just physical, why is Jessica in treatment? If sex is just physical, why is it worse if somebody rapes you than if somebody just physically assaults you? Because it's not just physical. It's emotional. It's psychological. It's spiritual. Here's somebody you can pray for. Pray for her family, too. So, God's nature is morality's true north. If he doesn't exist, nothing's ultimately right or wrong. Ladies and gentlemen, let me just ask you this quick question. Is the sexual abuse of children evil? Yes. Yes. Then God exists. Now, you can ask the question, why would God allow it to continue? That's another question. We deal with that a little bit in the book, Stealing from God. But what you can't say is God doesn't exist and call it evil. It's just your opinion if God doesn't exist. So, what can we draw from these three arguments? I think we can conclude that there's a spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful, moral, personal, intelligent creator who created all things and sustains all things every moment. Now, how do we know this is the God of the Bible? Again, we don't. It might be the God of the Bible, it might be the God of Judaism, it might be the God of Christianity, it might be the God of Islam. We don't know yet. Could maybe some other theistic God. Maybe all these are false in many respects. But if God truly did exist and wanted to tell us which one of these were true, what could he do? He could do something only he could do, and that would be a miracle. Because miracles can confirm that somebody speaks for God Why should people follow Moses? Because Moses can do miracles. Why should people follow Elijah and Elijah? Because they can do miracles. Why should people follow Jesus and the apostles? Because they can do miracles. In fact, a lot of people don't believe miracles are possible. Like Jonah, Noah. I mean, crazy, come on. Noah in the ark? Christians, you really believe that? I mean, come on. Crazy, admit it. A resurrection. Jesus rising from the dead. How many in here have seen somebody rise from the dead? Yeah, neither have I. Then why would you believe in a resurrection? And for some reason, the big problem miracle in the Bible is Jonah. Is that a whale of a tale or a tale of a whale? I mean, what's the deal with, can you really believe in Jonah? I mean, isn't that crazy? Now, question, what is the greatest miracle in the Bible? Now, it's not the resurrection. Maybe one of the more significant miracles, but it's easy compared to the greatest miracle. What's the greatest miracle? Yeah, the greatest miracle in the Bible is the first verse. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. If that verse is true, every other verse is at least possible. Well, here's the interesting thing. We now have good evidence that even atheists are admitting that the universe had a beginning. They're admitting that space, matter, and time had a beginning out of nothing. If that's the case, then these other miracles are at least possible. Because if God can create the universe out of nothing, then he can do whatever he wants that's not logically impossible inside the universe, right? I mean, he can create the whole show out of nothing. Can he do the Noah miracle? Can he do the Jonah miracle? Can he resurrect Jesus from the dead? Can he part the Red Sea? Can he make axe heads float? And he can do any of that stuff if he can create the whole universe out of nothing. Now, I just said something you might not agree with. I said God can do whatever he wants. It's not logically impossible. Some of you are thinking, wait a minute. I thought God can do anything. No, there's even some things God can't do. Like what? He can't do logically impossible things. Like he can't create a married bachelor. I know some guys try, but no, they're still married. Okay? He can't create a five-sided triangle. Doesn't exist. Can't create a one-ended stick. Doesn't exist. Can't create a square circle. Doesn't exist. Can't create an honest politician. Okay? There are some things that are just too hard for God. In fact, you can do some things that God can't do. What can you do that God can't do? Lie, right? If he could lie, then he wouldn't be the standard of truth. And if he could lie, he would be weaker than he is. He wouldn't be the standard. He can't change. What's he going to change from? If he's a perfect being, any change would necessitate a move from perfection to imperfection. If he could change, he wouldn't be the standard. So you can do things that God can't do, but if he could do them, then he wouldn't be God. Now, obviously, people today have a lot of problems believing in miracles. Like, for example, people say, well, I can't believe in something I've never seen. I've never seen a miracle. That's not a good reason to disbelieve miracles. Why? Because you believe in a lot of things you've never seen. You believe in your mind. Have you ever seen it? You're using it right now, I hope. You believe in the laws of logic. You ever seen those? You're using them right now. The laws of mathematics, ever seen those? You believe in justice. You ever seen justice? You may have seen it expressed, but you've never seen it. It's not a material thing. It's an immaterial. You've never seen love. It's not a physical thing. It's an immaterial thing. You've never seen gravity. Frank, we got you on that one. Look, there it is right there. There's gravity. No, you're not seeing gravity. What are you seeing? You're seeing the effects of gravity. In fact, that's how we know God exists. We reason from effect to cause. We know there's a creation, there must be a creator. We know there's a moral law, not just my opinion, but certain things are really right and really wrong, then there must be a standard beyond us, a moral standard. So we reason from effect back to cause. There's a lot of things that you've never seen that you believe. You believe in George Washington. You ever seen him? No, but you believe in him. Why? Because there's evidence for them. That's why. I've never seen the Himalayas. I believe that they're there. So there's a lot of things you've never seen that you believe in. And by the way, if miracles really have occurred, you ought not expect to see a lot of them, if any. Why? Because miracles, by definition, have to be rare events. If miracles occurred all the time, they wouldn't be miracles. We can only recognize miracles against the backdrop of regular natural laws. If miracles occurred repeatedly, we'd go, hey, this stuff happens all the time. It's no big deal. Right? I mean, there are things that happen that we ought to call miracles, but we don't because they happen all the time. How many people in here have ever seen your own flesh and blood born? Now, when you see that, You don't go, evolution. You go, this is amazing. How does this happens every day, but how does this happen that another human being related to me comes out of another human being? How does that work? We don't call it a miracle because it happens naturally. But you ought not expect to see a lot of miracles. If they occurred all the time, they wouldn't get our attention. I mean, suppose people resurrected from the dead routinely. What would the resurrection of Christ mean? I mean, you go to somebody and you go, Jesus rose from the dead to prove he was God, to show that he paid for your sins. And the guy goes, so what? Uncle Carl just rose from the dead 2 weeks ago. You know, now I got to give the inheritance back. No, it's got to be a rare event if it's going to get your attention. Miracles are rare events. So you shouldn't expect to see a lot of them, if any. The question is, have any miracles occurred since the first one? By the way, one other thing about miracles. David Hume, the famous deist, who died in 1776, came out with this argument against miracles, which actually is an invalid argument, but many people think it's good. One of the things that Hume said about miracles is you can't believe in miracles because they violate natural laws. Am I violating a natural law right now? No, I'm overpowering a natural law, right? Now, it's true that if an agent doesn't intervene, then natural laws will take over and pull this to the ground. But if an agent intervenes, he or she can overpower natural law. Now, if I can overpower a natural law, can the God who created and sustains natural laws overpower them? Yeah, of course. The question is, does he? And for that, we've got to go to our final question. And the final question is, has he done any miracles since the first one? Since the creation of the universe out of nothing? And for this, I'm going to mention seven lines of evidence, but only talk about two of them because we have limited time. And they all begin with the letter E. This is evidence that the New Testament writers are telling the truth. First of all, we have early sources. Early sources. All of the New Testament documents, or at least most of them, are written prior to 70 AD. And much of the data written down is much earlier. For example, probably the earliest data we have on the resurrection is 1 Corinthians 15, verses 3 to 8, which is an ancient creed that was written down in 55 AD, but originated, as even atheist scholars admit, all the way back to the resurrection itself. It's pre-40 AD. And that creed tells who Jesus appeared to after he was resurrected. We also have eyewitness details. There are 84 eyewitness details that have been confirmed by Roman historian Colin Hemmer in the second half of the book of Acts. There's also 59 historically confirmed eyewitness details or historically probable eyewitness details in the Gospel of John, put together by Craig Blomberg at Denver Seminary. All those details, by the way, you can see in the book, I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist, chapter 10. There's embarrassing stories in there. I'll explain what that means in a minute. We'll look at that in more depth. Same thing with excruciating deaths. Elaborate testimony. This one is a difficult one to explain without going through an example, and we don't have time for an example, but let me just say that this evidence right here is the best evidence you've never heard of that the New Testament writers are independently witnessing the same historical event. They couldn't have invented this. And if you want more on this, Google two words, undesigned coincidences. Undesigned coincidences. You can get the book Stealing from God, which has some of those in there, but you can get all that stuff for free by just Googling undesigned coincidences. Also, expected predictions. This deals with Old Testament prophecy. If I only had one Old Testament prophecy to make my case on, it would be Isaiah chapter 53. Have you ever read Isaiah chapter 53? If you haven't, go home and read it, and as you read it, you'll realize, hey, this is about Jesus. Yeah, the problem is, if you're skeptical, this particular passage was written 700 years before Christ. And we know it's prior to Christ because the greatest of the Dead Sea Scrolls, the 24-foot Isaiah scroll, has all of Isaiah 53 in it, has the entire book, and that scroll is dated to between 125 and 150 BC. In fact, that scroll is so significant. If you go to the Israel Museum in Jerusalem today, across from the Knesset, you'll see attached to the museum the Shrine of the Book Museum. It's a circular museum. And they made it circular to put this 24-foot scroll around a display. It's actually a facsimile of the real scroll. And when you look at this thing in there, you go, wow, this thing looks like it was written yesterday. Yeah, but it's 2,100 years old. and it predates Christ. Also, there's extra biblical writers. There's 10 ancient non-Christian sources within 150 years of Jesus' life who mention Jesus and the apostles very briefly. None of these people are eyewitnesses, except Josephus may have seen a couple of things after Jesus because he lived in Jerusalem or lived in Israel from 37 AD till he died in about 100 AD. He went to Rome for a while. Anyway, he was a contemporary, right after, contemporary of the apostles. Anyway, when you add up what these people say about Jesus and the apostles, you get a story congruent with the New Testament. For example, these people will say the New Testament writers believe that Jesus rose from the dead, they died and rose from the dead, and that these people, these apostles, were willing to die for their belief. They're not saying they believe Jesus rose from the dead. If they had, they'd be Christians. They're saying that the Christians believe that. Now, we only have time to cover a couple of these. Let's talk about embarrassing stories. What's embarrassing stories? There's a principle that historians use when they're trying to discover if an historical writer is telling the truth. It's called the principle of embarrassment. It goes like this. If there's something embarrassing to the author or authors, it's probably true. Why do you think it would be true? Because you're not going to invent embarrassing stories about yourself, right? You might invent stories that make you look good, but you won't invent stories to make you look bad. In fact, let me ask you guys this question. How many people in here have ever lied to make yourself look good? If you don't have your hand up right now, you're lying to make yourself look good. And it's not working. We know you're lying. All right, how many people in here have ever lied to make yourself look bad? You don't do that, right? You might do it temporarily, like if you're a pool shark or something, but you're not going to continually lie to make yourself look bad. Well, the New Testament writers have filled the New Testament with embarrassing details that they never would have invented. That's why we call this the dove factor. They're not making this up. Let me just give you a few of these, because there's a lot of them. Peter, their leader, is called Satan by Jesus. You think they invented this? Do you think Mark, who wrote this down at one point, said to Peter, "Hey, Pete, I'm going to make this a real interesting story. I'm going to have the Lord call you Satan." What do you think Peter would have said? Have him call you Satan. Why is he calling me Satan? Look, I'm the leader here. And then Peter, again, their leader, says, "Lord, I'll never deny you." What does he wind up doing? He denies him three times. That's embarrassing. And then at the crucifixion, all the disciples except one run away. This is like a Monty Python movie. Run away! They all run away. Now, who are the brave ones? The women, that's right. The women are the brave ones. Now, who wrote the New Testament down? Men. Now, what man is going to invent that he was hiding for fear of the Jews, why the women went down, discovered the empty tomb? Would any man in here invent that? Would any man here invent that? No, you wouldn't. If I was there, if I was inventing it, I'd make myself look good, right? I'd write something down like this. Let's see, we marched right down there confidently and overpowered that elite Roman guard. That sounds pretty good, don't you think? Peter said, "Get out." John, roundhouse kicked him. Philip said, "We'll be back." And then on Sunday morning, we marched right down to the tomb. And we saw Jesus, who congratulated us on our great faith. And then we went and comforted the trembling women. I would never say I was Mr. Sissy Pants. Why the women went down and discovered the empty tomb. And oh, by the way, why would you never say the women were the first witnesses in that culture? Forget about the embarrassment to men. Why would you never say that they were the first witnesses? Because a woman's testimony is not considered on par with that of a man. So if you're making up the New Testament story, you'd only have the men be the first witnesses. Yet all four Gospels say the women were the first witnesses, which is telling us what? They really were, as embarrassing as it was. The women were the first witnesses. I had a lady come up to me once, and she said, "I know why Jesus appeared to the women first." I said, "Why?" And she said, "Because he wanted to get the story out." I said, "That is an excellent point." Because, ladies, when your man comes home from work, does he say much? There could have been a nuclear explosion down at the plant. He's not going to tell you, right? You'll see it on the news before you hear it from him. You'll be watching the news going, "Hey, hon, what happened?" "Yeah, I forgot to tell you, the nuke blew up. I've been hot for 3 days. You know. What's for dinner?" Right? He's not going to tell you. Also, I can't even believe this verse is in the Bible. In Matthew chapter 28, this is the last section of the Gospel of Matthew, where Jesus is giving what's called the Great Commission. Go therefore, make disciples of all nations. In that same passage, it says, as they're waiting for him to do this, the disciples are there, and it says, and this is Matthew 28, 17, by the way, it says, some believed, but some doubted. He's standing resurrected in front of them, and they're doubting. And they're going like, hey, you see that guy right there? Yeah. That guy over there is Jesus. Oh, no, it can't be Jesus. He was just killed not long ago. No, I'm telling you, it's Jesus. It can't be. The Romans killed him. They crucified him. He's dead. It's him. It can't be. They know how to kill people. The spear went in his side. Blood and water come out. I'm telling you, the guy's dead. It's him. It can't be. It is. How do you know? The women told me. They're not making this up. There's even potentially embarrassing details about Jesus in there. You know, Jesus in Mark chapter 3 is considered out of his mind by his own family. His own family wants to seize him and take him home because they think he's nuts. Now, you may have heard some people say, the scholars will say, you know, the New Testament writers embellish Jesus to be God. Oh, really? Then why is Mark chapter 3 in there? Also, notice that Jesus, his own brothers don't believe in him. John 7, 5, that's very embarrassing. We learn later, however, that James, the half-brother of Jesus, who wrote that little book in the New Testament called? James. Excellent, excellent class. We learn that James, 30 or so years after the alleged resurrection, dies as a martyr in the city of Jerusalem. He's thrown off the Temple Mount by the Sanhedrin. And when he hits the ground, they stone him to death. How do we know this? No New Testament document tells us this. You know who tells us this? Josephus, the Jewish historian, who was probably in Jerusalem at the time. And also Hegesippus, a writer who lived later. They tell us that James basically dies as a martyr in the very city of Jerusalem Jesus is alleged to have risen from the dead in. Everyone would have known where Jesus' tomb was. Why is James, why has he had this change of heart? He didn't believe Jesus was God when he walked the earth, but after he's resurrected from the dead, he does. Paul tells us in the Creed, 1 Corinthians 15, 3-8, the one I mentioned earlier, it says that James, or Jesus, appeared to James, which must have convinced him that his own brother was God. I mean, before the resurrection, James said, yo, bro, you're not God. After the resurrection, he said, yo, bro, you're God. Now, how many people in here have a brother? All right, how many people in here have a brother who thinks he's God? Yeah, you don't believe in him either, right? Neither did James until the resurrection. Also, Jesus is called a drunkard. He's called demon-possessed. You think they invented that? That's embarrassing. He has his feet wiped with the hair of a prostitute, which he's going to be seen as a sexual advance. And oh, by the way, there are two prostitutes in Jesus' bloodline. Who are they? Rahab and Tamar. Do you think Matthew and Luke got together at one point and said, you know what, I really think we should spice up the Messiah's bloodline a little bit. Let's put a couple of prostitutes in there, Rahab, Tamar. No. In fact, there's a lot of shady people in the bloodline. Judah, from where we get the term Jew from, look him up. Not a good guy. David's in there. David, a man after God's own heart. Yeah, but he's a liar, adulterer, and a murderer. Gee, I guess there's hope for the rest of us, huh? Bathsheba's in there. In fact, one of the writers in the genealogy won't even mention her name. You know what happens when he gets to Bathsheba in the genealogy? He says, Uriah's wife. Ooh, he's telling the truth, but that's a slam. Why? Who's Uriah? Husband of Bathsheba, whom David had killed so he could have Bathsheba. They're not making this up, as embarrassing as it is. In fact, out of the five women mentioned in the genealogy of the Jewish Messiah, there's only one Jew. Rahab's not a Jew. Tamar's not a Jew. Ruth is not a Jew. Bathsheba's not a Jew. Who's the only Jew? Any Catholics in here? Mary's the only Jew. History of the Jews, one Jew. Think they're making this up? They're not making this up. They're just telling the truth. And by the way, there's embarrassing details in the Old Testament too, and a lot more in the book, but we don't have time to cover it all, so let's just move on to the final one, excruciating deaths. Excruciating deaths. And this points out that these writers and apostles who were in a position to know whether Jesus had risen from the dead or not died excruciating deaths when they could have saved themselves by simply saying, look, it never happened. Here's a painting of Peter being crucified upside down. We don't actually know if he was crucified upside down, but we know, we have first century evidence that he was, in fact, martyred. In fact, let's look at the apostles' beliefs and practices before and after the resurrection. Now, as we do this, very quickly, I want you to just keep one thing in mind, that the people who wrote down the New Testament, all of them, with the exception of Luke, were all Jewish believers in Yahweh. They were all Jews. They already thought they were God's chosen people. What motive would they have to invent a resurrected Jesus? Because before Jesus came, they believed in animal sacrifice. They've been slaying lambs and other animals to Yahweh for hundreds of years. Then suddenly Jesus comes along and they say, nope, Christ's sacrifice is enough. We don't need to slay these lambs anymore because these lambs are just symbols of the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. Here he is. Before, they believed in a binding law of Moses. Afterwards, Christ's life has fulfilled the binding law of Moses. In fact, Jesus himself does away with the dietary laws in Matthew or in Mark chapter 7, where he says, it's not what goes into a man that makes him unclean, but what comes out of a man. Before, they believed in strict monotheism. Afterwards, they're believing in a Trinity, three persons in one divine essence. Yes, I know the Trinity is hinted at in the Old Testament, but it's much clearer in the New. Before, they believed in the Sabbath. In fact, they thought they could be stoned for not obeying the Sabbath. Afterwards, they're worshiping on Sunday. And Paul even writes in Colossians chapter 2, don't let anyone tell you you have to obey any Sabbath or festival day. Why? Because the Sabbath represented rest. And once Jesus showed up, he is the rest. In fact, if you look up at the Ten Commandments, nine of them are repeated in the New Testament. There's only one that isn't. Keep holy the Sabbath. Why? Because the rest has arrived. Before, they believed in a conquering Messiah. Afterwards, a sacrificial Messiah. Before, they believed in circumcision. Afterwards, baptism and communion. Now, question, ladies and gentlemen. What would cause these pious Jewish believers in Yahweh, who thought they were God's chosen people for over 2,000 years, what would have caused them to abandon everything on the left and adopt everything on the right virtually overnight? The only thing I can think of is what psychologists call an impact event. What's an impact event? An impact event is an event that occurs in your life that is so impactful that it can change your perspective 180 degrees like that. Some impact events are so dramatic, you might not remember what you had for breakfast this morning, but you'll remember an impact event that occurred 10, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago if you're old enough. In fact, there's probably only a few in here that are going to be able to answer this question. I see a few people from the community in here, but I'm going to ask it anyway. If you can remember where you were and what you were doing November 22nd, 1963, raise your hand and hold it up high.
I was behind Cole Hall.
Ladies and gentlemen, well, that man knows where he was. Ladies and gentlemen, look at these people with their hands up. You see these people with their hands up? These people are very old. November 22nd, 1963 is my earliest memory. I was 2 years old and 2 days. Yes, I'm 56 years old. I know. I don't look a day over 55. In fact, when I hit 50, my wife was very encouraging. She said, honey, you're going to live to be 100. I said, how do you know? She said, because you look half dead already. Anyway, I'm a toddler in the living room in our home in Wanamassa, New Jersey, and my mother is sitting on an ottoman in front of a black and white TV weeping uncontrollably. Mommy, what's the matter? They killed the president. President Kennedy assassinated that day. I can still see my mother in my mind right now that day when she was 26 years old. She just turned 80 two months ago. But I can see her right now as if she were sitting right there right now. That's my earliest memory. I don't remember anything before that and very little after that. By the way, who else died that day? C.S. Lewis and Aldous Huxley, two very notable people, one a Christian, one an atheist. Where were you when the second plane hit the tower? Some of you are old enough. You had it on. I was in my home office near Charlotte, North Carolina, and I had the TV on behind me, and I was talking to a pastor in North Charlotte, and he wanted me to come to his church, and we were trying to figure out what the topic would be. And I said, you got the TV on? He goes, yeah. I said, maybe a Cessna hit the World Trade Tower. And then we're just talking, And suddenly he screams into the phone. He goes, the second tower just got hit. I turned around, look at the TV, the second tower's on fire. I said, was it a Cessna? He goes, no, it was like a United plane. It was a passenger plane. It flew right in there and exploded. I said, you saw that? He goes, it was just on live TV. I said, look, let me call you back. I hung up the phone. For some reason that morning I had CNN on, the Communist News Network. And I'm not making this up, but the commentator on CNN said, one has to think there's some sort of navigational error here. He said, navigational error? You doofus. This is the clearest day in the history of the Big Apple. What do you think, Stevie Wonder's flying these planes? I mean, they can't see where they're going? No, this has got to be terrorism. Now, 9/11 was over 16 years ago. Those of you who are old enough can remember something about that day. But if I were to ask you, where were you 16 days ago? Most of you are going to go, I don't know, let me look at my iPhone. What was I doing that day? I don't know. Why can you remember something from 16 years ago but not 16 days ago? No impact event 16 days ago. Impact event 16 years ago. Do you think if Jesus really rose from the dead, that would have been an impact event? Do you think if Jesus of Nazareth really walked out of that tomb and performed miracles after that and was seen for over 40 days, that they would have remembered that? That they would have remembered everything he said and did till the day they died? Of course. That's the only way I can figure out why these Jewish folks would have abandoned everything on the left and adopted everything on the right virtually overnight. In fact, what did the New Testament writers have to gain by making up a new religion? Remember, they're Jewish believers in Yahweh. Why are they doing this? What did they get by saying this was true? They got excommunicated from the synagogue, and then they got beaten, tortured, and killed. Last time I checked, that was not a list of perks. We're going to start a new religion. We are? Yeah. What's it going to get us? Well, first we'll get kicked out of the synagogue, and then we'll get beaten, tortured, and killed. Well, sign me up. You know, what a great idea. Why haven't we thought of this earlier? No, I don't think so. In fact, they had every motive to say the resurrection did not happen, not every motive to say it did. In fact, sometimes I get the question, are there non-Christian writers that talk about this? Yes, I mentioned them briefly. The details are in chapter 9 of the book. But you know what is often underneath that question? You really can't trust the New Testament writers because they were religious people, see? And religious people embellish things. They invented it. You really got to look at the objective secular writers to know what happened. If you think about that for more than 10 seconds, you'll realize how silly that objection is. Why? What did these people have to get by saying it was true if it wasn't? Nothing. They gave up everything. You can trust these people because they had no motive to invent it. Every motive to say it didn't happen. Why would they die for a known lie? You say, wait a minute, Frank, there are some people that will die for their religion today. How does that prove Christianity? Right? How does it prove that? For example, there are some people in the Muslim faith that will kill themselves. Does that prove that Islam's true? Islam and Christianity can't be true on Jesus. Why? The New Testament documents say he rose from the dead. The Quran, Surah 4, verse 147, says he never even died, much less rose from the dead. They both can't be true, yet they both have martyrs. Isn't the martyrdom thing kind of a wash? No, why? Well, there's a number of differences between the Muslim martyrs of today and the New Testament martyrs of New Testament times, so let me just give you the one difference for our purposes here. The Muslim martyrs don't have the kind of evidence that Islam is true that the New Testament martyrs have. The New Testament martyrs were there. They saw Jesus. They touched Jesus. They ate with Jesus. They verified with their own senses that Jesus had risen from the dead. You see, many people will die for something they think is true that really isn't, but nobody will die for a lie they know is a lie. And the New Testament writers were in a position to know whether it was a lie or not, and they went to their deaths anyway. You can't get better evidence than that unless you were there yourself. Now, we could spend more time, but we don't have it. We don't have more time. In fact, let me sum this up this way. The New Testament writers did not create the resurrection. The resurrection created the New Testament writers. In fact, what I'm going to say for you people who believe in the Bible, like I do, who believe the Bible's inerrant and all that, what I'm about to say, you might consider heresy. But it's not. Just stick with me. Christianity is not true because a series of historical documents we put under one binding says it's true, the Bible. In fact, Christianity would be true if the Bible never existed. What? How can that be? Christianity's not true because a book says it's true. Christianity's true because an event occurred. The resurrection. There would be no New Testament if the resurrection hadn't. What are Jews inventing a New Testament for if it didn't happen? They're not. In other words, Christianity is based on an historical event. If that event didn't occur, there would be no New Testament. Do you realize there were thousands of Christians before a line of the New Testament was ever written? Right? I mean, Paul's a Christian before he starts writing. Peter's a Christian. John's a Christian. Matthew, why are they Christians? Because they witnessed the resurrected Christ. Then they wrote it down. Now, thankfully, God saw it fit to inspire the writers to write it down so we could know more about it. But it would be true whether or not they ever wrote it down. We just wouldn't know much about it. So, again, there's more there, but we've got to sum this whole thing up. Does truth exist? The answer is?
Yes.
Somebody says there's no truth, you're going to say? Is that true? Does God exist?
Yes.
We just went through three arguments for a spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful, moral, personal, intelligent creator. Are miracles possible?
Yes.
Well, the greatest miracle has already occurred, the creation of the universe out of nothing. And is the New Testament true with regard to the resurrection? It sure seems that way. If you want to go further, you can. There's the books out there. The DVDs are out there. There's that website again. If you want this, type that into your browser. This PowerPoint presentation, we'll send it to you. We're now teaching online courses. In fact, we're teaching this course, Why I Still Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist, beginning April 9th online. And you can interact with the instructors live. I'll actually be live online answering questions. There's several other courses you can take at our website. We're on YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook. In fact, we're streaming this live on Facebook right now. Say hi to the Facebook audience, if you would. Hey, Facebook audience. In fact, we're so into YouTube, Twitter, and Facebook, we've actually combined these three into one social media platform. We call it Twitface. Don't forget radio and TV. And if you don't do anything else, download the free app. Two words in the app store, cross-examined. Two words in the app store, cross-examined. It's got the TV show streaming. It's got the radio show and podcast. And it also has a quick answer section for many of the issues that we've already talked about here tonight. So download that if you will. All right, last thing before we get to your questions. We now have got to draw some implications here. It's true, you might say. Well, so what if it's true? What does it matter? What does it matter if Christianity is true? In order to answer that question, we've got to answer this. Why did Jesus come? You know, he actually told us why he came. He said, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Now, some of you are going, ransom? What does that mean? I don't need, if God exists, I don't need somebody paying a ransom to God to get me off the hook. I'm a pretty good person. I can make it to God on my own. Nobody needs to pay a ransom to get me off the hook. You know why we think that? Because we have a relative moral standard in our mind from the moral giant Mother Teresa down to the moral midget Hitler. And next to Hitler, we put criminals. We know they're not quite as bad as Hitler, but they're bad. Next to criminals, we put all the immoral people we all know. You know, our immoral friends and relatives who aren't quite as good as we are, because our picture's right here next to Mother Teresa. And then if we believe in heaven and hell at all, we arbitrarily draw a line in the sand and we say, these are the bad people, they're going to hell, and we're the good people, we're going to heaven. This is not a good way to think. Why? Because, sure, maybe you're better than your neighbor, but you're still fallen. You've still done evil things. If God is just, and he is, you deserve punishment. So comparing yourself to somebody else doesn't help. In fact, the line doesn't run up and down between people. The moral line actually runs across the top, and all of us have fallen short of that line, from Mother Teresa on down to Hitler. And what Christ has come and done is he's lived the perfect life in our place and then took our punishment on himself. And that by trusting in him, you not only can be forgiven, but you can be given his righteousness. Think about that. You're not only forgiven, but you're given what he's done. If that's true, and I think it is, then it truly is the greatest story ever told. The God of the universe enters human flesh and tries to save the very creatures that rebelled against him. There's no greater love than someone who dies for his friends. Now, the problem is that we don't recognize the price that was paid for this to happen. Brace yourself for this.
As long as I remember, I've been walking through the wilderness, praying to the Father, and I'm waiting for my time. I'll come here with a mission, and soon I'll give my life for this world. I'm praying in the garden.
Somebody actually did die for you, just like Michael Monsor died for his friends. When I was in the Navy, I was in naval aviation, and we earned naval wings, but the United States Navy SEALs earned golden tridents. It's the most difficult insignia in any military in the world to earn. Most Navy SEALs, or people who try for Navy SEALs, don't make it. But those that do make it, that trident is their identity. When Michael Monsor was buried in California, just about every Navy SEAL on the West Coast showed up to his funeral. And as they passed his casket, they took off their golden tridents and pressed them into his casket. They took their identity and put it in their Savior. That's what we're supposed to do. Our culture tells you to take your identity and put it in everything other than your Savior. Put your identity in your political party. Put your identity in your race. Put your identity in your gender, in your sexual orientation, in your job, in your pocketbook, in whatever it is. All those things pale in comparison to putting your identity in the One who created you and died for you. You're never going to experience true contentment until you learn what you were created for. You were created to know your Creator, who came and laid down his life for you. Put your identity in what he did. By the way, this is the best baby ever, right here. That little girl has been sitting there with me ranting and raving for 2 hours. Amazing. Have you ever accepted him? It's free. Why wouldn't you accept it? You say, I don't want to give up my life. Well, that's your choice. You don't have to. It's up to you, though. Why wouldn't you? It's free. If you have given him your life, does anyone know it? Or are you an undercover Christian? If they were to drag you into a courtroom and try and convict you of being a Christian, would you be convicted or would you be acquitted? No, it's not enough evidence here. Let this person go. If you'd be acquitted, you might want to reconsider how you've been living. The least you can do for him after what he's done for you is to let other people know that as imperfect as you are, as imperfect as I am, we stand with him. Now, before we get to your questions, I want to recognize a few people in here who are very important people to me, and maybe to you too. How many have heard about the movie God's Not Dead? Well, there's a third edition coming out. The man who wrote the book is here. And he's right in the back there. Stand up for a second, Rice. Rice Brooks, there he is. God's Not Dead author. The man behind the movies. And by the way, there's a third movie coming out in about a week called God's Not Dead, Light in the Darkness. So look out for that. The man sitting next to him is Dr. Michael Guillen, who is a Harvard PhD in physics and is a man who actually interviewed Stephen Hawking. Michael, say hello, would you? Raise your hand right there. There he is. Another great man here in Nashville is my friend Doug Powell. Doug, stand up right there. There's Doug, who has written several apologetics books himself and is also a fabulous musician. Go to DougPowell.com. He's got some amazing apps that you will love for your iPad. Apps in archaeology, New Testament, Old Testament, that kind of thing. Go to DougPowell.com. Do I have that right, Doug? Go there, check that out. Next to him is Rick Altizer. Rick is a movie maker right here in Nashville. Say hi to him. Done a couple movies on Chandra Pierce you may have heard about. What's the name of that? What's the first one?
Laughing in the Dark.
Check that out. You'll love it. Who else am I forgetting? That was probably somebody I'm forgetting. Addison, who made this happen, and Jerry, all the way from Haiti, helped make this happen too. Say hi to him, right there. You know him because he dominates on the Commodore basketball team, right? All right. So what we're going to do now is we're going to go to a period of Q&A. And before I go to Q&A, I do want to mention Addison. Tell people where you guys meet, when you meet, so if people want to join the group that you have here on campus, they can.
You guys are getting ready with your questions. Every Nation Campus, we're campus ministry here at Vanderbilt, and here to serve you if you have any spiritual needs or questions. We currently meet now at the Biscuit. You guys heard of Biscuit Love? It's a little restaurant. It's right off campus. We moved our meetings right off there. We know the owners there, and they let us use their space. We meet Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock at Biscuit Love. We have students from Lipscomb and Belmont all come over there as well. So you're welcome every Wednesday night. I'd love to have you come visit. So.
All righty. We may have to adjust a couple cameras here. Do we have to do that, Clint? So people in Facebook land can see and hear. Are we good? All right, so we're going to do questions here. Try and keep your questions short if you can. Here's the microphone. Come right down here so people can see you and see you in internet land. Yes, sir. This gentleman was at my last event, or one of my last events.
February 20th. Very good.
University of Tennessee.
UTK Knoxville.
You live here or you live
drive,
there?
3-hour drive for me today.
Well, thanks for coming.
A friend of mine. Yeah.
Give me your name again.
I'm Faithless Forrest.
Faithless Forrest.
All right.
Go ahead, sir.
And like last time, I have more than I should be allowed. There should be a line behind me.
Yeah, come on, line up now.
If there's not
so
a line behind me, I'll keep going.
Line up now.
So, just like last time, I want to try and address some of the... I'm going to call them problems with how you talk about cosmology, and then I would eventually like to talk about that foundation of morality again, just like last time, but I'm going to start with cosmology. You talked about there being a beginning of the universe, and I want to say that there's a kind of a problem with that, that the word universe is so ill-defined that your arguments are... We're going in circles and talking past one another. And to help
Forrest,
everyone...
let me define the universe. Space, matter, and time. The space-time continuum we're living in right now.
All right, I heard you. But for the benefit of others here, in the physics community, there's new ideas being developed, and that means we may need to talk about what does it mean to be the universe or not. And a problem like this happened about 150 years ago.
Okay, all right, Forrest, hang on one second. We got to get to a question pretty quickly here, because we do have a line foreman behind you, so.
And I'll confess, this is not a question. It's me going to say that the word universe is not well-defined,
okay,
and you're misusing it.
Okay, fine. Yeah. Whatever you want to say there. Let's go to a question, if we could.
I'm trying to think how I turn this into. Do you think that the Andromeda Galaxy is another universe?
No.
Well, about 150 years ago, it was called another island universe. Mm-hmm. And as we talk about things like the Big Bang and maybe things that might be before it or a cause of, then the whole question of what the universe means arises, and your presentation doesn't deal with that well. And there are physicists who give serious idea to the thought of these multiverses, as well as there's this marvelous thing called colliding membranes, and your presentation does not serve your listeners well to not acknowledge them. If you want questions, are you familiar with the membrane idea that the membranes collide? This causes this repeating universe, which you don't like. You're going to say entropy is violated and so on, like you did in Knoxville. Are you familiar with the membrane colliding theory?
Yeah, hang on 1 second. I'm looking for something here. Hold on. Stand by for vectors, Victor. There's all sorts of different theories out here, as you know, Forrest.
And we should say hypothesis, because
right, yeah.
Hypotheses are things that don't have evidence behind them yet.
Okay.
In fact,
yeah,
we're
well,
struggling to find ways to test them.
You can say anything you want, but there's a difference between a possibility and evidence for a possibility. Right? You can say that we were all created by green leprechauns, but that doesn't mean that that's a theory that has evidence behind it. What has happened over the past 50 or so years has been that the standard Big Bang cosmology has taken all sorts of attacks from all sorts of different directions, oscillating universes, membranes, all this kind of thing, and it has come through as still the standard model for good reason.
Do you understand that the Big Bang theory merely says that the universe went through a hot, dense phase about 13.8 billion years ago? It does not say that there was a creation event before that. That's one of the possibilities.
There's a lot of possibilities, but
a lot of
even
hypotheses.
I could go through quote after quote here from cosmologists.
I think we served my purpose. Your first bullet in that slide that had, it said creation, teleology, I'm going to mangle that word. Help me with that word, teleology. There we go.
Teleological,
and moral.
You go.
That first bullet, we've now demonstrated you've made a strong claim than you want. You've made a claim stronger than you want. I'm ready to surrender.
Okay, let me just, before you go, Forrest, I just want to point something out. Let's say, I don't grant this, but let's just say that somehow there's a new cosmological theory that comes along that supplants the Big Bang, right? Because science, as you pointed out,
Supplant it. It will enlarge it, the Big Bang will be a special case of, or
all right. Let me make my point, okay? Let's just say that cosmology is tentative, because science is tentative. This is not tentative here, what I'm about to show you, that shows that time had a beginning. This is a philosophical argument for the beginning of time. Here's today, there's yesterday, there's the day before yesterday, there's last week. Question, can this line be infinite into the past?
Yes.
How could it be infinite into the past and today have arrived?
It can be infinite if there is no beginning. What we do see is that
please answer the question. How could today have gotten here if there's an infinite number of days before today?
I believe that we are struggling against inadequacy of the English language, which lets us construct nonsensical questions.
How is it a nonsensical question to say that there can't be an infinite number of days before today for today to have arrived?
I think maybe I can try and address that by saying, can you hand me a piece of this nothing that was before, and we can talk about its properties?
You're sounding like Lawrence Krauss now. No, nothing is non-being. Non-being, nothing.
Do you have a piece of it that we can examine its properties?
No, because nothing is not a piece of anything.
So you're
right,
making philosophical assumptions yourself.
Forrest, yeah. Okay, you don't have an answer, I understand.
My answer was that we don't have evidence of a beginning. That was my answer.
This is evidence of a beginning right here, because for a couple reasons. You can't traverse an infinite number of days to get to today. Secondly, you can't be at the end of an infinite, right? Because an infinite is something that has no end. But here we are at the end of the infinite. Thirdly, you can't add anything to an infinite, But tomorrow we're going to add another day, and the day after that we'll add another day, and the day after that we'll add another day. So there can't be an infinite number of moments before today. By the way, this argument was brought forth by a Muslim philosopher about 800 years ago and has since yet to be answered.
Did God have a beginning?
What's that?
Did God have
no, good
beginning?
Question. Let's go to your question. Yeah. Thank you, Forrest.
Oh. Well, I actually had a different question.
Well, that's okay. That's okay. What's your name?
I'm Ben.
Hey, Ben. How you doing?
Good. How are you?
Good.
Cool. But I guess in regards to his, though, at least the argument in terms of, well, if it was an infinite past, then it would never got to the present. So if there was a beginning, then that beginning must have been a point, right?
Say that again?
I'm trying to, making sure I understand, but I guess, does God have a beginning then? I mean, wouldn't he have had to have a beginning?
No, because there has to be something that's uncaused and eternal. It's either the universe or something that transcends the universe.
So why couldn't it be the universe?
Because the universe has a beginning for this argument and several others I haven't even talked about yet, as even Stephen Hawking and others have admitted.
But even if the beginning of what we can understand about our universe is the Big Bang, then how do we know that it didn't actually exist before that, but maybe it came to that point of the superheated mass that blew up?
Well, what cosmologists will say is you can't go through a singularity, that a singularity point of infinite density, and if you think about that for a minute, it sounds like a contradiction, and it is, because you go from nothingness to something. There must be something that transcends the physical world. If space, matter, and time had a beginning, then whatever created it has to be spaceless, timeless, immaterial, powerful, personal, and intelligent in order to create. Now, if you're timeless, the second attribute there, do you have a beginning?
No.
No, that's the point. God is not in time. He transcends time, so he didn't have a beginning. He is what Aristotle would call the unmoved mover, or what the Old Testament calls the great I am, the being that just bees. It had no beginning and will have no end.
But why couldn't the universe be that?
Well, potentially it could be. The problem is the evidence shows it isn't.
I mean, all the evidence shows is that at one point there was a superheated mass.
No. The evidence shows that it came from nothing, non-being.
Okay. I guess I'm not familiar with the evidence.
Okay.
We obviously don't have enough time to.
Right. And then this philosophical argument shows that time can't be infinite. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here right now.
Okay. Yeah.
Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think so. So my other question was about morality, actually.
Uh-huh.
So, if I understand what you're saying, then you're saying that there is an absolute good and there's an absolute evil.
No, hold on. Evil doesn't exist on its own. It's not a dualistic thing where good and evil are equal opposites.
Okay.
Evil only exists as a privation and a good thing. But
okay.
Go ahead.
But essentially there is a good, though.
That's God's nature, yes.
Right. And there are things that are good that can't be explained in any other way other than a God being there, if I understand the moralistic.
Well, people try and explain goodness absent God, like Plato would say, well, there's these Platonic forms, you know, justice just exists external to us, independent of God. The problem with that is, why am I under any obligation to follow justice rather than injustice if these things do exist? And secondly, how can justice actually be just if it's not just? If it's an immaterial, impersonal thing known as justice, then it seems odd to say that justice itself isn't just.
Okay, so at least my thoughts on this, perhaps would it be possible that what is good is just what is considered actions that care for other people? And then this is kind of enforced because our society enforces it. And then also that evolutionarily this was enforced because to have a successful society, we had to have these standards, and then any society that didn't would have fallen compared to the people that were able to
mm-hmm.
form a successful group because they had these moral standards.
Okay, let's just deal with one of those. You brought a lot of different issues up to bear there. Let's talk about evolution being the source for morality, because you hear that quite a bit. Can evolution account for morality? First of all, Moral laws are not chemical or biological. They are immaterial and come from personal agents, right? If evolution does occur, evolution has no authority to tell you what to do. Oughts come from ought givers, or laws come from lawgivers. Secondly, chemistry and biology are descriptive, not prescriptive. Evolution describes what does survive, not what ought to survive. Why human beings? And why people like you rather than the Nazis? Why should you survive, not them? Also, should we rape to survive? I mean, if it's all about survival and passing one's genes on, then why do we have a barrier against rape if evolution is our guide? Also, should we murder the weak to help others survive? That's what Hitler wanted to do. He wanted to take or protect the super race by getting rid of the undesirables. To him, that was homosexuals, gypsies, Jews, and Jehovah's Witnesses. Why shouldn't he have done that if it's all about survival? And since evolution is a process of change, then morals must change. Rape may one day be good, according to this. And then you mentioned cooperation. Why cooperate when not cooperating often helps you survive? Like, take Stalin, for example. Who did he have to cooperate with? Just his henchmen. He killed 20 million of his own people.
Did Stalin survive well, though?
What's that?
Did Stalin survive well, though, with his non-cooperation?
Oh, sure he did. He survived very well. He died at the age of 74 on his deathbed, shaking his fist at God one last time.
How about Russia, though?
Well, that's irrelevant to the question. I mean, Russia went on long after Stalin left. The point here is that you can survive better by killing somebody else sometimes and taking their stuff, should you do that.
But your community doesn't survive better because of that.
Why do you care? Because if there's no standard beyond you.
But your community, so does an individual fare better than a community in terms of surviving in the world?
Well, Ben, what you're importing now is some moral language into your system.
I just mean survive. No, I mean like a community has a better chance of surviving than an individual.
But which community? Our community? The Nazi community?
Just
Stalin's
in general.
Community? I mean, the history of the world is replete with tribes and states fighting one another. So should they fight one another or not?
No.
Okay, well, if not, then you're saying there's a standard beyond those states or tribes that says, hey, don't do that. If one state wants to overtake another state, and you're saying they ought not do that, you're appealing to a standard beyond both of the states. Just like we appealed to a standard beyond Germany and the United States when we convicted the Nazi war criminals on war crimes.
But I think that they shouldn't fight each other for the reason that it ends up hurting both communities.
Okay, but
so in the end, it would actually be harmful for our survival.
That's what you're employing, moral language. What's your moral standard?
That wasn't moral language. That was purely survival language.
No, you're saying it would appear better morally. But why is survival good?
No, I said it would be better for the survival of it.
Why is that good? Why is it better to survive?
Because survival is how evolution occurs.
But remember, whatever
survives is what we see.
Evolution is not prescriptive. It's descriptive. It doesn't tell you you ought to do something. It tells you what happens.
That is true, in the sense that evolution is just what happened to survive.
Okay, so you're not talking about morality then. You're describing what happens, not what ought to survive. We're talking about oughts here when we talked about morality.
Yeah, all I'm saying is, well, I think perhaps my wording is suggesting something that I'm not meaning to suggest, because when I say better, usually it doesn't mean in a moral sense or an ought to sense. But in terms of just better as in increasing your chances of survival, and so evolution would occur due to the increased chance of survival. I think that might be what's happening here,
Ben,
I guess.
If Christianity were true, would you become a Christian?
Yes.
Okay, if I gave you a book, would you read it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, eventually.
But you will?
Yeah.
Okay, well, make sure you meet me at the book table and I'll give you one.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's good. Thank you.
All right. Yes, sir. What's your name?
My name is River.
Say again?
River.
River, come on up closer to the mic if you would, River.
Sorry, I'm soft-spoken.
Yeah, you got it, man. Go ahead.
Well, first off, for anything, we have a long line of service in the Air Force, and you know, mentioned the Navy, so it says commendable.
Air Force?
Yeah.
You go.
Oh, master.
Got two sons in there.
Yeah, if you have to go military, I'd say Air Force, because you get all the toys and the whistles, but they all go to the funding. But also, I was trying to take notes earlier. Sorry.
I'm from New Jersey. You can't take notes on me. I speak at 150 words a minute with Gus to 350. Sorry, man.
I'm saying I was noticing a really charismatic kind of flow to you, and words kind of blend in the way that you, implications can be mixed up with intentions. Mm-hmm. And so, I kind of lost count, but I did make just a few quick things here. You mentioned about the making stories and so on.
Embarrassing stories?
Right.
Yes, sir.
So I think, it's along the lines of, egoism and so on, some of our baser psychological impulses. We're not too quick to make stories about ourselves that give us our worst, disposition to reciprocation and so on. But, I have lied to make myself look bad because, I care about the people around me and it's circumstantial, And so I'll take a hit, take them for the team, right? Because I'm worried about them more than me. I can take it. Mm-hmm. I want them to be okay. Mm-hmm. And I'd say that's, I'm a little better at this. I'd say that's just from natural empathy, which was mentioned a couple of times now. But kind of the thing there is that the is-ought comes up, right? And that's mm-hmm. something I think about. I think that's a matter of framing as well.
All right, let me ask you this, River. Is there mm-hmm. a reason you're saying that? Do you think it negates the arguments from the embarrassing testimony that the New Testament writers wrote down? Do you think that they were inventing that? Is that what you're saying?
Well, that's the thing. I mean, there's a lot of books out there, and I have no reason to believe any of them over any others. I can go, different accounts, different scholars, theistic, non-theistic, etc. And just to clarify, atheism is not it's an right? It's a negation of a claim. It's not saying there is no God. It's saying I'm not convinced of it.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay, just to clarify.
Well, hang on one second about that. You're basically saying that atheists lack a belief in God, right?
It's been who you ask, right? There's the classical thing if you have theism, atheism, agnosticism. Right. That's the classical thing.
Yeah.
I'd put it more into theism, atheism, Gnosticism, agnosticism. One is knowing, one is belief.
All right, let me just ask you a question about that, because there are three possibilities. You say God does exist, you say he doesn't exist, or you say you're not sure. Which one of those are you closest to?
I would say I'm not sure.
Okay, you're an agnostic then. You're not an atheist.
Well, no. If you're theistic, the claim there is that there are God or gods. If you're not convinced of it, you don't know. So you would be, if you're not sure, say the specific one, like, say, Maat or Isis or Thor and so on and so on.
Okay.
Right? That would be a theistic claim for, let's say I'm theistic in the way of I think Thor exists.
All right, yeah, but here's the difference. The God of the Bible is not like, and we might say the God of Islam too, is not like superheroes. They're not created beings inside the universe like Thor or Ra or Zeus. Those are beings, mythical beings that are created beings inside the universe. What we're saying when we talk about God is we're talking about a spaceless, timeless, self-existing, immaterial source and sustainer of all things. So we're not competing with Zeus and Thor. We can make our evaluations on whether those beings exist inside the universe, regardless of our beliefs about God, the theistic God, okay?
Right, so I'm getting off all track, sorry, but something
right.
I thought
River,
about.
River, if you could come to a question, because
right,
we've got
right.
a long line behind
okay.
you. Go ahead,
right.
go with your question.
Right, so part of the question, in the sense of not knowing, and there could perhaps with the text of discovery, et cetera, in the process of not knowing, I was curious, I wanted to go more into, thought process. In the sense of if good things are classical Euthyphro, right? What's your response to Euthyphro?
Okay, Euthyphro dilemma. Here's the way the Euthyphro dilemma goes. Does God do it because it's good, or is it good because God does it? This is from a dialogue that Plato had. There's a character in there called Euthyphro. He says, does God look up at a standard beyond him and says, oh, I'm going to do that? Or does God just arbitrarily make up a standard? In either case, it seems like God is irrelevant, because if he looks up at a standard beyond him, why do you need God? And if he's just arbitrary, well, we don't need God for that either, right? The problem is this is not a true dilemma. A true dilemma is A or non-A. This is A or B. Maybe there's a third option, and it turns out there is. God doesn't look at a standard beyond him. If he's looking at a standard beyond him, he's not God, that's God. And he doesn't arbitrarily make up rightness. He is the standard of rightness. So the third option is that God is the standard. The buck has to stop somewhere, and it stops with God's nature. So the Euthyphro dilemma is a false dilemma. It doesn't work.
I've heard that before. I have some time aside, so I have one question, and I'll... Line's building, sorry. Is any action, finite action, appropriate for any infinite reward or punishment? And I'll leave you with
is
that.
Is any finite action appropriate for infinite punishment? Now you're asking a moral question.
Right, I am.
Right, okay. Now my question back to you, if you're an atheist, is, well, what's your moral standard to say anything's right or wrong? Well, but I'll leave that aside.
Back to empathy.
Because I want to get to your question,
right,
okay? Right. First of all, there could be reasons that God punishes somebody for eternity if you're sinning against an infinite being, and secondly, you continue to sin in hell. Who said you stopped sinning in hell?
Right, and then but then you wouldn't be yourself in heaven either, based on all the descriptions, which is limited. But
well, you're in a glorified state in heaven.
Right, and then I've heard that before about the... If you're a glorified state, you can see that your sister who died, or your uncle, your aunt, your families, they're all burning torturers for all eternity, and you're okay with that.
All right,
time
out, time out, and this will be the last thing I say. The Bible doesn't talk about torturing anyone.
It's separation
from God,
et cetera.
Torment is the word that's used, and torment is internally inflicted, not externally inflicted.
Right, okay? And people send themselves there, et cetera. So, but,
okay, thank you for your question, River.
But
let's
okay,
go to the next right. next question. Yes, sir.
Right, thank you.
Yes, sir, what's your name?
My name is Paul, and I speak much louder. Sorry.
You what?
I speak much louder.
Oh, there you go.
It's the Navy in me.
All right.
All right. So, one, thank you very much, sir. Thank you for this opportunity. I would like to highlight my beautiful wife over there of almost 19 years. So,
hey, beautiful wife of 19 years. How you doing?
Her name's Jen.
Hey, Jen.
So, first, a quick favor to ask. Can you say, Zachariah, I'm sorry you're wrong, but relativism is not a true thought?
Zachariah, I'm sorry you're wrong, but relativism is not true.
Thank you. That actually settled an argument at work.
All right, good.
I appreciate that.
Mm-hmm.
So here's my real question. My real question is, how would you classify someone who teaches deification of man, bringing down Jesus Christ as only human, even if it was for a short period of time, you know, he took vacation for 30 some odd years, teaches kingdom now theology, and also promotes the little God's doctrine of the name it and claim it word of faith movement? How would you classify it?
All right, well, let me just deal with the word of faith movement first, because that one troubles me the most, and here's why. The word of faith movement says that if you're not healthy and wealthy, it's because you don't have enough faith, right? That God wants everybody to be healthy and wealthy. I think that can be refuted by one simple observation. Jesus and the apostles were not healthy and wealthy. Don't tell me they didn't have enough faith.
Thank you.
In fact, they even say that Jesus says, if they persecute me, they're going to persecute you. Paul says that if you try and live a godly life in Christ Jesus, you will be persecuted. So I think the word of faith movement is a problem, also because it gives people a false idea of who God is. God is not a cosmic candy man who gives us everything that we want. In fact, earthly fathers don't give kids everything they want. If they do, what happens to the kid? The kid becomes spoiled. So you can't give kids everything they want. God doesn't give us everything we want for our own good.
So you would classify anybody who teaches those things I mentioned, what exactly?
Well, you mean put a name on it?
Well,
it's bad. All right, what do you want me to say?
That's good enough for me. Thank
okay.
you very much, sir.
All right, good, good. Thank you.
I don't think we need to go any further than that. So thank you, everybody, for your patience.
All right. Thanks, Zachariah. Hey, Brian.
Hey, how's it going?
Good.
So, great presentation. You left me with enough things that I want to respond to that if I did, we would be here all night. So I'll just narrow it down.
Brian's the head of the Secular Student Alliance, so there you go. We had dinner, so
yeah.
Say hi to Brian. There you go.
Hey, SSA.
Hey, Brian. Go ahead.
So, yeah, there's just a couple points I want to, I guess, focus on that really stood out to me. So you put a lot of emphasis on the embarrassing details.
Yeah.
So I have a couple points that I just want to list out real quick and then just get your response to.
Sure.
There's a number of examples in ancient mythology that of embarrassing details. Like, for example, in the account of Hercules, he has a fit of rage and kills his family. Mm-hmm. In the writings of Homer, well, not really writings, but in you know, the works of Homer, Odysseus's men, his soldiers are often presented as a bunch of bumbling idiots who get him in trouble. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, Josephus uses women as source material when he's writing the Jewish War, like in his account of Gamala, for example. Mm-hmm. And so I'm just wondering if we know that an ancient writer who lived in, you know, in Jerusalem, or in at least in Israel around the time of Jesus, who was a respected historian, used women, then doesn't that mean that women occasionally were trusted as historical sources? And then the presence of embarrassing details of characters and heroes in, like, for example, Greek mythology, doesn't that kind of...
Well, yeah, when you're talking about mythology or just like a novel, yeah, you're going to have a lot of embarrassing details. That's what it's about. It's it's about making it more interesting if it's a novel.
So then my question is, how does that serve as a standard for what's historically accurate if it also occurs in mythology?
Well, because the embarrassing detail argument doesn't stand alone. It stands with all the other E's that I put up there, okay? Well, which shows that they're not writing mythology. Mm-hmm. They're writing what they believe to be true, and then they go and die for it.
Right, so I understand that you can build a case for the resurrection, or you can build a case for the historical reliability of the New Testament Gospels.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
On the basis of these other criteria, but then the embarrassing detail kind of falls away, doesn't it? Because
it occurs
in other mythology.
Well, if it was mythology, but see, we know that Hercules or whatever you mentioned is mythology. We know that. Mm-hmm. This is being put forth as true, and these are historical characters, which, by the way, in our book, I Don't Have Enough Faith to Be an Atheist, which I know you have, in chapter 10, I think it is, maybe 9, we list more than 30 historical characters in the New Testament documents that are also in secular sources and or archaeology. So this is a story about real life. It's not Homer or it's not Hercules. It's not mythology. This is put forth as being true. And then there's other evidence that it's true. As you know, being an archaeologist or somebody interested in archaeology, you know there's archaeological evidence for some of these things.
Right. But the existence, you know, being able to verify the historical existence of a person doesn't necessarily mean that you've verified every account or every detail
true.
Of their life.
You can't verify everything in the New Testament or the Old Testament. You can. But when you get enough evidence to suggest that they're telling the truth, you can take the rest of that and go, well, if they're telling the truth here, they're probably telling the truth here.
Okay, so on that basis, is it all right if I move on to another question?
Oh, sure, go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm going to be up here until you tell me to go away, which is fine. You know,
all right, let's just do one more, and then we'll move on. But go ahead.
Okay, sure. So the Gospels were written, you know, a few decades. I'll back up by saying, you know, the first you mentioned during your presentation that the earliest reference or the earliest literary reference is the preservation of the pre-Pauline Creed in 1 Corinthians 15. So the Gospels were written a few decades later, after the initial source says that Jesus died and rose again according to the scriptures. So a preface to my question is that 1 Corinthians 15 cites according to the scriptures, you know, Hebrew prophecy, as the source material for justifying belief in the resurrection of Jesus, in the death and resurrection of Jesus. So
it might be, or it could be, the Gospel of Luke.
I'm sorry?
Could be the Gospel of Luke, because Paul quotes the Gospel of Luke in 1 Corinthians.
Right, but this is the creed that predates Paul. So are you saying that the creed was citing the Gospel of Luke? Like, are you saying that the Gospel of Luke was written in the early 30s CE?
Maybe I'm misunderstanding your point. What do you?
Oh, I'm talking about the creed itself, not the writings of Paul.
Well,
I mean, just...
I'd have to look at the creed again to see exactly the wording in it. Hang on a sec. Let's see if I even have it here. I might not even have it here.
It says
in any event, your point is you think it's referring to the Old Testament. Is that what you're saying?
Right. It says according to the scriptures, and this is the earliest known reference to the resurrection we have.
Okay.
Sorry, it'll take me a minute to get to the question, if that's okay.
All right.
So the Gospels were written decades later after an initial source says Jesus died.
Decades
and rose
later than what?
Decades later than the emergence of the creed. So if the creed, it dates to the early to mid-30s CE, the Gospels were written you know, generally the scholarly consensus is somewhere in the 60s to 70s, 80s, you know, in that
range.
Yeah,
well, I don't agree with all that consensus. In fact, I think Luke is certainly written in the 50s. Because okay. Acts is written by 62.
Okay, so at least two decades. So I still stand by decades later.
All right, maybe.
I mean, we can probably have an hour-long conversation about the dating of the Gospels alone, but in any case, they were written many years later. You know, 50s would entail at least 20 years later. So we have one initial source that very simply says Jesus died and rose again according to the scriptures. Then many years later, several other authors write detailed narratives about those events. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul also says that several people had appearances or visions of the resurrected Jesus. So one plausible scenario that I could think of, again, I'm coming at this from a non-believer perspective, is that Jesus was, in fact, a charismatic, apocalyptic Jewish prophet who preached a countercultural message, countertemporal message, and was killed by the Romans for the crime of sedition because he was alleged to be the king of the Jews. And in the following months, a few of his followers had visions of Jesus, which led them to think that he had been resurrected. And the story spread by word of mouth until a few decades later, when people wrote compelling dramas that mix fact and legend. So my question is, while we can deliberate about, you know, whether or not an author would have included embarrassing details in a semi-mythical, semi-historical narrative, what actual historical evidence allows us to know where to draw that line between verifiable historical events and literary embellishment? Because if a single creed predates or precedes all other Christian works, how do we know that those later works are actually independent rather than stemming from that single initial source?
Well, part of it is an elaborate testimony, which I didn't have the opportunity to tell you about, because when you look at the undesigned coincidences, you realize there's no way they could have invented these details, because they're witnessing the same event but giving different details about the same event that they couldn't have independently known, or they couldn't have known unless they witnessed it independently. Also, as I said, embarrassing testimony isn't the only of these evidences, if you will. Early eyewitnesses, eyewitness details throughout there that only an eyewitness would know. And then you had mentioned something. You know how you get older, you start to lose your train of... Thank you. You had mentioned something related to this, and I was going somewhere with it, and it's escaped me now. The biggest problem in the theory that they just had visions is the empty tomb. But could just go to the tomb. Everyone knew where the tomb was.
But the tomb narrative was in the Gospels, so it didn't occur until a couple decades at the earliest, after the accounts of visions started to occur. So it could have been a later invention.
If it's the empty tomb is a later invention?
Well, if the earliest, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but the earliest account that actually references an empty tomb comes decades after the initial sources start talking about having visions of a resurrected Jesus.
They're not claiming their visions. They're claiming that he's literally risen from the dead.
Well, they said they had appearances of Jesus. I mean, that could be explained equally as well as by a resurrected Jesus as it could by visions.
Right, but that's why in Luke he says, I'm flesh and bones. I'm not a ghost. You can see me. Also,
right, but that's decades later.
Also the Romans and the Jews could have stopped this by simply going to the tomb, even if the empty tomb thing came later. Mm-hmm. It would have been easy for the Christians to say, "Oh, he rose spiritually." They didn't say that. They said he's physical. And if they're saying he's physical, there's a way to disprove that. Go to the tomb. Find the tomb. And nobody could find a body in the tomb because it was empty. That's the point. In fact, a majority of scholars today, whether they're atheists or Christians, agree that the tomb was empty.
Well, I have to question the accuracy of the majority of scholars. I mean, if most people writing about the empty tomb are Christian scholars, then of course, you know, there's going to be a bias in favor of majority.
Let me say that again. Mm-hmm. The majority of scholars, whether they're Christians or atheists, New Testament scholars, the majority of them agree that the tomb was empty.
Do you have a source you can cite on
that?
Sure,
Gary Habermas, Liberty University, who has done the most research. He surveyed, I think, over 3,500 sources on the resurrection. He's done more research on the resurrection than anybody ever has. He has what's called the minimal facts approach to the resurrection.
Yeah, I'm familiar with it.
Yeah, so if you look up Gary Habermas, you can go to GaryHabermas.com and look it up.
Okay, do you know just off the top of your head, like what percentage of those scholars who are...
Empty tomb?
Not-
What percentage are over 75% empty tomb? How many of them are Christian? How many are atheists?
Exactly.
I don't know. Gary would know that. But he's saying they're across the spectrum.
Okay, and without committing ourselves to an appeal to authority fallacy, do you know what evidence they base that on, the empty tomb? Because it's more why.
Well, no, I haven't read all 3,500.
Okay, but my point is that the reason for the consensus is more important than the existence of the consensus.
So I totally agree with you. Yeah. You just can't take authority without any evidence behind it.
Right.
But the question is, why would so many people say that the tomb was empty? It was easy to squash Christianity. The Jews and the Christians, no matter how many decades later, wanted to squash it. Obviously, the Jews wanted to squash it right before 70 AD.
But if they accounts of the
gone
empty,
gone to oh, the sorry. Tomb and just squashed it.
Right, but if the accounts of the empty tomb didn't start to appear, or didn't start to be mentioned or passed around until decades later, it may have been too late to have squashed the rumor. Who's going to keep track of all the tombs in Jerusalem that long? Especially considering Jerusalem was destroyed in the 70s AD
by the
Romans, and so it could have been destroyed at the time.
Again, remember, the creed, as even Bart Ehrman agrees, it's like within months of the resurrection.
But the creed doesn't mention the empty tomb. It only mentions that Jesus died and rose again according to the scriptures.
Right, and that he appeared to all these people. And why are they changing their lives if they're Jews? Why are they changing their lives if they think it's just a spiritual resurrection?
That would be a really long discussion, so I think I'll end it here.
All right, well, thank you, Brian. Thanks for being here. Yes, sir. What's your name?
Jace.
Hey, Jace. How you doing?
Pretty good. Quick question. So this is more like, I don't know if you're going to actually have facts to back this up, but more so a theory.
I don't have any facts, man. It's all my opinion. Go ahead.
Okay. Then you probably fit very well here.
Okay.
So Richard Dawkins has said that we're just machines that are made for...
we're dancing to our DNA. Yep.
Yeah, we're dancing through our DNA. And we are machines for propagating DNA. The propagation of DNA is a self-sustaining process. And I was wondering if, he's like the Pope for atheists, why they're so bad at doing that, if that's the main thing. Like, we're supposed to be nice to our neighbors as atheists. That's the moral standard that they have. You can't do this because it kills people and all that sort of thing. And I actually just read this article from an atheistic gay man who doesn't have any kids, and said that he's scared because unless the heterosexual atheists stop using condoms and start having more kids, that God isn't going to go anywhere anytime soon, suggesting that unless atheists get with it and stop using protection and stop not having kids, then atheists will be going away. And I know there's other studies that suggest that atheists are a small minority because they're not really good at procreating.
All right, Jason, I'm having trouble following the question.
Why is that?
Should atheists have more sex? Is that what you're asking?
My question is...
Because I think many of them would agree.
What's your theory on why they're not so good at that?
They're not so good at what?
Procreating.
Atheists?
Why, from your experience, going around and spending a lot of time with
that
atheists.
Would be just my opinion, so I don't know.
You don't know?
I don't know.
Okay. I was just wondering.
Thank you. Yes, sir. What's your name?
My name is Frank. That's F-R-A-N-K.
I like that name, sir.
You like that?
Very good.
What I know about miracles, I learned from Lee Strobel's webcast last Wednesday, and your treatment made it some undetermined time last week about addressing Hume's opinions on miracles.
Yes, sir.
And I noted with interest that both in your podcast, in your broadcast, and tonight, you emphasize the fact that a miracle must be rare.
Mm-hmm.
You then qualified it by saying miracles must be rare or we wouldn't notice them.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd like to push back on that a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I know there's a problem because if a miracle repeats itself with great regularity, the philosophical naturalist will say that while we don't have the natural scientific explanations for why something happens, we're confident that with more study we'll find it.
Mm-hmm.
Now, in my opinion, you describe what I consider to be the greatest miracle of all, and you took about 10 minutes to do it. And it culminated in one which I think is demonstrably not explained, and that's the magical, miraculous transition from the meat computer to a mind.
Mm-hmm.
Some people would say to a soul. And I'm just wondering if you yourself really do believe that miracles have to be rare, or we're really only in a position to discuss miracles that are rare. Otherwise, they get buried in the scientific studies and the confusion and the lack of any real answers about, for instance, how a mind arises.
I think it depends what you mean by rare. I think it's a consciousness is better explained, obviously, by theism than atheism. This is why Daniel Dennett, one of the new atheists, says consciousness is an illusion, because he can't explain it materially. Now, one wonders if he was conscious when he wrote that, right? I mean, here he is exempting himself from his own theory, and that's part of the problem. He's saying that consciousness, he's saying everybody's consciousness is an illusion except mine, in effect, because he has to be conscious enough to write books to say that there's consciousness is an illusion. By the way, the only way you can know it's an illusion is you'd have to get outside of the illusion. In other words, the only way you could know you're having a dream is to wake up and say, oh, that was just a dream. In other words, you got to get beyond the dream to know that what you had there is just a dream. For Dennett to say that consciousness is just an illusion, he'd have to get beyond consciousness. He'd have to have some kind of super consciousness to say that the regular consciousness we all have is just an illusion. He'd have to be someone like God to say that. So I think if you're going to define a miracle as consciousness, I wouldn't define that a miracle. I would say that God is behind it. I would say miracles are these events that occur around certain individuals normally that get us to realize that this guy speaks for God. And normally it's an overpowering of a natural law.
Well, I believe you said in your podcast that one of the characteristics of a miracle is it's a violation of...
It's not a violation, it's an overpowering, right? Okay. Like you can overpower natural law. Jesus right. walking on water overpowers a natural law. Jesus right. raising the dead overpowers the natural process of death.
Okay, well, let me back up and just say or ask, are you suggesting that miracles by definition cannot be frequent but unrecognized?
Well, they could be frequent if God wanted to do it that way. Just if he did it that way, we'd all go, well, that's no big deal, right? I mean, Craig Keener has written a hernia-inducing two-volume set on miracles. In fact, I'm going to have him on the radio program later this week. It's incredible. He thinks there's good testimony for even resurrections occurring today, but they're very rare. I mean, if resurrections were common, then we might go, the resurrection of Christ is no big deal. That's my only point. One of the problems is with somebody like Hume who says that miracles are a rare event and the evidence for the regular is always greater than that for the rare. One of the problems is Hume is punishing miracles for being rare when that's the nature of miracles. They have to be rare if they're going to get our attention. If they occurred all the time, we'd go, hey, no big thing. This stuff happens all the time. It'd be some sort of natural event, we'd think. So I think they have to be rare if they're going to get our attention.
Okay.
All right. Thanks, Frank. Yes, sir.
Hello.
What's your name?
My name is Daniel.
Hey, Daniel.
I'm curious to know if there is a question that you are most afraid to receive because maybe you don't have a fully comprehensive, backed up answer.
If you're going to ask me, am I ignorant in a lot of things, the answer is yes. So try and find one of those subjects. Go ahead. You know, we're all ignorant just in different subjects, right?
Okay.
Go ahead, Daniel.
I mean, I didn't have an example. I was just...
Oh!
What is the most... I guess the follow-up is, what is the most... what is the question you're most afraid of to receive?
That one.
What about the second?
Well, I think that questions on evil and why does God allow evil are difficult questions to answer in this venue because of the amount of time we have, right? I mean... You talk about questions related to evil, you could spend semesters on that question, right? And here you get 2 or 3 minutes to talk about it. So questions aren't necessarily hard to answer, but they're hard to answer in 2 or 3 minutes. That's the problem.
So is there a question that is hard to answer for you with respect to faith and Christianity?
Oh, I'm sure. I don't know if... I mean, to be honest with you, questions that... we get at these kind of forums are often repeat questions. That's why I have slides for them, as you can see.
Yeah.
Right? So Solomon said there's nothing new under the sun, right? In fact, there are four major categories of objections to Christianity. And they all begin with the letter E. Just, I don't know why. Evil, evolution, ethics, and eternity. The questions normally fall into one of those categories. Every once in a while, there's something outside that category, but 90% of the questions are in those categories.
So you'd say it's the ones that are just outside of those categories?
Yeah, there's a few. Okay. Like Brian's asking a question about New Testament. That's doesn't often come up, but sometimes it does.
Yeah. Okay, cool.
All right, thanks, Daniel. Yes, sir.
Good evening. My name is Chris. I'm from Calvary Chapel here in Nashville.
Oh, I love Calvary Chapel. Yeah, you know Jack too. Hibbs?
I do, yeah.
Great guy.
He doesn't know me. I
don't know. Oh, all right.
Hey, there you go.
Hey, Jack.
Hey. I would like to say that my mother was healed of epilepsy in 1968.
Excellent.
And she's 81 now.
Beautiful.
And when I was a kid, I remember she had seizures, and she became a Christian. She wasn't a believer. She became a Christian and was healed. And, you know, the doctor said, you can't throw your medicine away. And she said, well, I did. And she's 81. But that's a sidebar.
Well, let me mention that in addition to Craig Keener's book, Lee Strobel, who Frank mentioned a minute ago, has a new book coming out in a couple of weeks called The Case for Miracles. I've had an advanced copy, and I'll have him on the program as well. And he's got some very good documented cases of miracles.
Great. My question is really, I would really like to hear you comment. And Jesus said that that the Spirit of truth would convince the world of sin and righteousness and judgment. Mm-hmm. And I would just like to hear you comment on the role of the Holy Spirit in changing a person's mind about the truths of the New Testament and who Jesus is, and I'll sit down.
Well, I think the Holy Spirit, I think you've already answered it. The Holy Spirit goes out and, as you say, convicts the world of sin. But that doesn't mean that you can't grieve the Holy Spirit, that you can't say, no, I don't want that. I think everybody has a choice to make at some point whether they're going to receive the Holy Spirit or reject the Holy Spirit. So the Holy Spirit is necessary. We would not seek him if he didn't seek us first. But I think he seeks everybody. And at some point we keep rejecting him, he's just going to give up on us because he knows we're never going to turn back to him. Yes, sir.
Hey.
What's your name?
My name is Aubrey.
Aubrey, how you doing?
I'm doing well. How are you?
You're a winner of what? What's the...
Donating blood.
Oh, all right. There you go.
It matters, man.
Way to go. All right. Go ahead, sir.
So, first of all, I just want to say thank you for all that you do. You and Mr. Powell both. I joke with my friends and say that y'all are my unknowing mentors because I just really enjoy the study because I used to be very much so skeptical about a lot of things having to do with just theism in general until I started looking into it. And to me personally, and this is my opinion aside from my question, when you look into it more and have... When people think that it contradicts itself, like the Bible and stuff like that, in my opinion, they don't really fully understand it, and they have yet to actually do enough, like, looking at why are they saying it, specific things like that. So that's another thing. But the more that I got into it, and you, Mr. Powell, I'm actually reading one of his books. But so just thank you for that. But my question lies within the church today, whenever we have questions or controversies, specifically, like, in... Now, I just want the record to show I view women and men equal under God, that mm-hmm. we may have different roles, yet we are 100% equal mm-hmm. through salvation and stuff like that. But one of the biggest controversies I've found, especially amongst like my church, would be, or the church that I attend, is in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 11 through 15, where the Apostle Paul says, you know, I do not permit a woman to teach or observe mm-hmm. authority over a man, and so on and so mm-hmm. forth. It's come into question, they say, but if you notice, the Apostle Paul says, I do not permit. Mm-hmm. So at what point, how would we respond? Because I personally believe that if the Apostle Paul says it, then he's imaging God, or else why is it in the Bible? Why would he contradict the like God and it find its way into the Bible if it's Paul and not him through him? But how can someone reason through that, I guess?
Well, there are some commands in the Bible that are cultural. And not universal. I think Paul talks about that in 1 Corinthians. I'm trying to think of the verse right now. I don't think it's 14. Is it 14?
What chapter 7?
About 7. I say, what's he talking about there, Addison? I can't.
Marriage.
Once it gets toward 10 o'clock, my brain shuts down. What is it?
Saying yeah. if you can't marry, it's better not to marry, or it's if you can avoid lusting, better not to marry, so you can devote your full attention to the Lord. He says this is a commandment from the Lord.
Yeah, yes, sir. And in fact, the Bible even uses human forgetfulness. Like Paul even says in 1 Corinthians 1, he says, I don't even remember who I baptized. And you're going, what? Yeah, it's written just like he was with his own memory lapses and all that. I don't even remember who I baptized. And then he goes on to say, I didn't come to baptize, I came to preach the gospel. And then you go to Romans 1, and it says, well, the gospel saves. So that's the way, one reason you know that water baptism isn't essential for salvation, because Paul didn't even come to baptize, and he separates it from the gospel. So right. You have to look at each of these and see whether this is a cultural command or a universal command, and you've got to evaluate that. Now, my colleague, Dr. Norman Geiser, who's far smarter than I am and has written 100 books, he's written more books than most people have read. One of the books is called The Big Book of Bible Difficulties, and if you get that book, I think he treats that passage in there. I don't have the passage memorized off the top of my head, but I would highly recommend you get that book, The Big Book of Bible Difficulties.
So in your personal opinion, because that was the issue lied with, should women be lead pastors? I personally believe that they can fall under any category under a lead pastor, but that role specifically is reserved.
That seems to be what Paul is saying.
Okay.
Equal in essence, but different roles and function. The same thing is true with the Trinity. God and the Son are equal in essence. They're both divine, but they have different roles. The Son has a subordinate role to the Father.
Right.
But that has nothing to do with their essence or their worth.
Right.
Different functions, same essence.
Okay. Thank you very
much. All right. Good question. Thank you. Yeah. Yes, sir. What's your name?
Hi, my name... Oh, jeez.
It's working.
Hi, my name is Bang. And,
hey, Bang.
Just a disclaimer. I'm not trying to, like, prove anything. I'm just generally... curious.
Sure.
So do you believe that reason alone can prove God's existence? Can reason alone lead someone to salvation?
Reason alone?
Yeah,
no, obviously. I already mentioned the Holy Spirit. But see, there's a difference between belief that and belief in. Belief that is getting evidence that God exists, that Jesus rose from the dead. That's what apologetics is, giving evidence. But belief in is trusting in what you know to be true, what you have good evidence to believe. So there's a difference between belief that and belief in. We know this in relationships, right? When I first met my wife 32 years ago, I got evidence that she would be a good wife, but all the evidence in the world didn't make her my wife. I had to take a step of trust in her to ask her to be my wife. And in a momentary lapse of judgment, she said yes. See? See, so there's a difference between belief that and belief in. You can reason your way to say, I think it's true that Christianity really is the true worldview. You can reason your way to that. But to go then to trust in, the Holy Spirit has to seek you, as Chris had already mentioned. And I think he does that. Does that make sense?
Yeah. Follow up?
Sure.
So what do you think is the proper role of apologetics? Is it to defend the faith or more to spread the faith?
Oh, it could be all, right? Look, Jesus is actually an apologist. When... John the Baptist is in prison, and he sends somebody to Jesus. Are you really the Messiah? I mean, he's having doubts in prison. Are you really the Messiah? What does Jesus say? Just have faith. What's wrong with you? No. What does he say? He says, look at the miracles. Look at the evidence that I am. Look at the signs. Jesus is an evidentialist. He's saying, see the evidence. So Jesus is telling us that. Paul tells us, to demolish arguments and take every thought captive to Christ. Peter says, always ready to give an answer for the hope that you have. Paul reasons from the scriptures with the Jews and without the scriptures with the non-Jews. Like on Acts 17, he's talking to the Athenians. He doesn't quote the scriptures. He quotes their own poets to point out that there's a God beyond the universe.
Thank you.
All right. Excellent.
Hi, my name's Chad.
Chad.
I talked to you earlier before this. I got a question. A lot of objections when I try to witness to somebody is they say, well, I'm good, I'm saved because I'm a Mormon. Now, when we say Christianity is true, and then we say, okay, this is Christianity, it's true, and this is how it's true for this type of people. They try to say, you know, with the golden tablets, the more revelation to Christianity to make it whole. Now it's whole. Now we can go out and spread the gospel.
Okay.
How do I refute that?
Well, what you do is you don't refute it. You just ask them to support it.
Okay.
right? You don't have, when somebody says something, it's not your job to refute what they say, it's their job to support what they say, right? So if they say, well, Christianity's been updated, what do you mean by that? What do you mean it's been updated? And then how'd you come to that conclusion, right? What evidence do you have for that? Golden plates?
Yeah.
That could be a miracle, but you can make golden plates in your garage, right? Yeah. So what's the evidence you have that this came from God? And then you might ask, have you ever considered that the evidence for classical Christianity is quite good? And by the way, most Mormons, well, let me not say most Mormons because that might not be true, but the official Mormon doctrine is polytheism.
Yeah.
You know, as man is, God once was. So you might ask the person, do you think there are many gods? And, you know, again, what evidence do you have for that? Well, I had lunch with a Mormon once, and I was going through the cosmological argument, you know, because I was pointing out that there's one infinite being. And what do you do with that? Because he thinks there are many gods. And when I went back to the beginning of the universe, all he said to me was, oh, we don't go back that far. And I said, well, wait a minute. I mean, if this is what the evidence points to, you just can't kind of ignore it, right? Mm-hmm. So I would ask those questions. What do you mean by that? How'd you come to that conclusion? Have you ever considered? By the way, those questions are from Greg Kokel's book, Tactics. If you haven't read that book, even if you're an atheist, you ought to read that book. It's a good book, okay, just on how to converse with people. And those questions are also in the app, the cross-examined app. Now, by the way, let me just say one thing about these questions. These questions are good for any subject, not just for Christianity, atheism, whatever, you know. Parents, you ought to be using these on your kids, right? You know, if your kid calls you one night and says, Dad, I'm not going to be home at 11 like you wanted me to, your first question should be, what do you mean by that? Your second question, how'd you come to that conclusion? Your third question, have you ever considered if you're not home by 11, you're grounded for 2 weeks? Be right home, Dad! Right? By the way, husbands in here, never, ever use these questions on your wife, okay? Because if she calls you an idiot, don't say, what do you mean by that? How'd you come to that conclusion? I mean, she's going to have a list 25 years long, right? You're dead. You're toast. Okay? So don't refute it. Just ask a bunch of questions.
All right. My last question is, and this is not, I believe this is not subjective, but objective. So objectively speaking, who is the greatest theologian? And I'll sit down with that.
Well, I think that'd have to be Jesus. Ooh. Wouldn't you think so?
Where's my...
Do you want me to record something for you?
Maybe
Jen can record it.
Living today?
That's too hard. I don't know. Joel Osteen?
No,
I'm just kidding. I'm just sorry. Even the atheists are laughing at that. Come on. No, I don't know. There's so many of them. You know, I'm partial to the guy who taught me, Norman Geisler. You know, he's written a systematic theology that, well, if you dropped it on your toe, it would break your foot. Okay, so all right, last questions. Quick one for us, quick one.
Well, you know they're not quick.
Well, it's got to be because
the
second
law
of thermodynamics is running
But you've heard this one before. In one of your slides, you say that without a deity, we can't create a moral construct. Remember that slide has three bullets? If you want to bring it up, that might be helpful. All right, I thought you were reaching for it. You know, it was, we got creation, the teleological argument.
You mean that, or are you talking about like this?
No. That's kind of like it, but it wasn't the one I was thinking of. It's the one you used as you led into the
cosmological, teleological, moral?
Yeah.
Okay, we know what those are. Go ahead.
That strikes me as a challenge, and therefore I am going to construct a moral framework, which you've heard before. I've written it out a little bit. First, I observe that I can feel pain at various levels. I will label this suffering, and I insist that if need later, I can add whatever adjectives and adverbs are needed to add more information about how that word is defined. Next, other people tell me about their ability to suffer, and I can observe what appears to be their suffering. I have no reason to doubt their ability to suffer is substantially like mine. Last, some living non-human creatures also appear to be able to suffer. You know, cats and dogs and creatures like that, they can suffer. I will assert that as we live life, we should go through it to minimize suffering. Notice I can't say that we eliminate all suffering. And I also do not claim that I know enough to know that I'm getting the right minimization. But as events present to me in life every day, some of which I've never encountered before, I have to make my best effort to minimize suffering because I recognize that I can suffer. Is there anyone here that doubts that you can suffer?
Okay.
Is there anyone else that doubts that we can't?
I think I got...
I believe I've just constructed a moral framework.
Okay, all
right. You can argue it's inadequate, but I have just constructed a moral framework independent of
Forrest,
a deity.
Forrest, yeah, I never said you couldn't construct your own moral code independent of the deity.
Did,
you can
now,
do that.
Then
the
please make
is,
a concession that we can.
No, no. The question is it objective or is it just your opinion? That's the question.
Okay. To observe something is to see it in the real world. I observe my suffering.
Okay, let me...
Does anyone here think
Forrest,
that
Forrest,
my suffering
Forrest, we got
is
limited
just
time.
Made up?
Let me just respond. You can observe suffering, but why is suffering wrong if there's no God? Who said?
What I said... So, we agree that suffering exists. What I said is that the moral framework says that we should probably try and act to minimize suffering.
But why? Who said?
Because I can feel suffering
and
know...
Who cares if you can feel... If I'm Stalin and I want your stuff, okay,
so
why
we,
can't I make you suffer and take your stuff?
And that would be unnecessary suffering and is evil. I win. I win. I just won.
Why is it evil? Who said?
I said it is unnecessary.
It's not unnecessary. I need your stuff.
Stalin created unnecessary suffering. Do you believe that? Did Stalin create unnecessary suffering?
Okay.
Does anyone want to contradict that?
Okay.
I have constructed a moral framework.
Forrest, you can construct anything you want, but it's just your opinion unless it corresponds to God's nature. Yeah. That's the point. Thank you for your question. Let me move on. This one gentleman has the final question,
right,
and then we got to go. Because the universe has an infinite number of days before today. That's impossible, but this seminar could go on for an indefinite period of time unless we choose to end it, and we're going to end it right here. Yes, sir. What's your name?
I'm Joey.
Joey, how you doing?
Good. How are you?
Give me an easy one.
Okay, this is probably relatively easier.
All right.
So say we come to the conclusion that, you know, we believe in a God, we believe in Christianity even.
Mm-hmm.
So I know that there are more than, I think, 30,000 different mm-hmm. denominations of mm-hmm. Christian.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm a Christian, I'm an Orthodox Christian, and I mm-hmm. personally think that my denomination is the correct one. So mm-hmm. how do you pick among the tens of thousands of choices of Christian denominations,
this is going to sound surprising, but I actually think in most cases, or in many cases, denominations are good. Why? Because Christianity can be expressed in many different ways, sometimes through liturgy, sometimes through a more free-flowing service, sometimes through certain kinds of music and other kinds of music. And this is what most denominations who believe in the Bible differ over. They don't differ over the essentials, what C.S. Lewis would call mere Christianity. They differ over the non-essentials, music, liturgy, mode of baptism, these kind of things.
What about like whether baptism is essential, for example, whether communion is Christ's body and blood? These seem like
right.
bigger theological.
But they're not salvation issues, right? Now, someone might say, well, water baptism is essential for salvation. I just think they're factually wrong on that. The thief on the cross didn't get water baptized. Also, like I just mentioned, 1 Corinthians 1, Paul says, I don't even remember who I baptized. I came to preach the gospel. And in Romans 1, he says, the gospel saves. So I think that's pretty clear cut. Now, somebody may be mistaken about that.
What about unless one is born of water and spirit, they cannot enter the kingdom?
That's true. You can't enter the kingdom of God unless you're both born through your mother and then you're born of the Spirit. You're born again. So that's true. That's what Orthodox Christians believe. And Orthodox, I mean, I'm not talking about Greek Orthodox. I'm talking about Christians who believe in the essentials of Christianity, right? And the essentials of Christianity are, there is a God, you are not him, neither am I, right? Jesus came, lived the perfect life, died a brutal death, and by trusting in what he's done, we can not only be forgiven, we be given his righteousness. Okay, these are some of the essentials of Christianity. Just about everybody who believes in the Bible agrees with that. Okay, now, mm-hmm. sometimes there are denominations out there that depart wildly from the scriptures. Well, that's their fault, right? I mean, that's not your fault if you're following the teachings as closely as you can. That's their fault. But I think in many ways, some denominations, having a plurality of denominations, are good if they really trust that the Bible is true. There are several denominations out there that don't even think the Bible is true. They hardly believe in God. As my colleague, Dr. Norman Geiser says, these are no different than hymns singing rotary clubs, right? They get together, they sing hymns, but they don't even really believe in God. All right? Does that make sense?
Yeah, thank you.
All right. Thanks for coming out, folks. And thanks to our folks on Facebook. We'll see you next time.